right, everybody. Welcome to the October 5th meeting of the Hadley Select Board. We're calling the meeting to order at 7 o'clock p.m. And the first order of business is the consent agenda. On the consent agenda this evening, we have approval for the September 21st meeting minutes. We also have request for approval of a one-day liquor license for top of the campus at the Mullen Center at the university. Those dates are for October 21st, 28th, 29th, November 4th, 12th, December 2nd, 3rd, 16th, 17th, and then January 3rd, 14th, 31st, and February 7th, 18th, and 24th of 2017. We also have a request to accept the resignation for Mark Schlosser as of October 3rd, 2016 from the police department. And we have policy approval for several new police department policies regarding temporary light duty, nepotism and fraternization, less lethal shotgun-based impact projectiles, a tattoo policy, civilian ride-along policy, issuance of awards of recognition, school resource officer, community liaison officer, and detective. And then we have a note approval, borrowing note approval, for a loan note, is that March 2016? It says DW-16-03.
The contract, I think, and then the note.
And then in the amount of $249,971. And that's an interim
yes,
loan note?
That is the interim 0% loan, which allows the state to release the funds to pay the invoices that we have been paying so far. They will now reimburse us for the amounts that we have advanced. I think the loan approval, the loan date goes back to March 16th.
That's what it looks like.
Everything's been done a little bit topsy-turvy on this because we were going to go as a private note and then we ended up with a water loan, mm-hmm. which is good, especially when you get to the 0% for a period of time. I'm not sure exactly what triggers the rollover to a permanent note, but mm-hmm. when it rolls over permanent, it will be for 10 years and 2%. But in the meantime, we've been paying the bills, they will pay us back, and until such time as it rolls into a note, there won't be any interest on it. I think there's a really small, a few hundred dollars for an origination fee, but other than that,
the
project for this was the Route 9 project.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right. And I think that you read the amount of the approval was over 300, but the
249.
Yes, this is going to be for the 249.
Correct. So do I have a motion for the consent agenda?
I'll make a motion.
Can we discuss something?
Yeah, you want to do a motion made and second? And then
that's fine.
Okay.
Motion to accept the consent agenda.
Second?
Okay, second for discussion.
I just want to know if there's any new information on the negotiations with the meal tax, anything?
With the meals tax?
Yeah, talking to UMass.
So we've opened up the conversation with the town of Amherst on the meals tax. So we're proceeding on that front.
But nothing to report yet.
Nothing to report.
And the other question I have is the concession stands are now going to be selling beer, which they haven't done in the past. I always thought it was solely in the club, athletic club up top. Is this something new?
So these are one-day liquor licenses for specific events associated with football and with ice hockey. The concession stands cannot sell beer without a liquor license from the town of Hadley.
But I didn't think they sold it in the past at the concession stands at the Mullen Center, the basketball and hockey games.
Yeah,
I was under the impression they only sold it at the club facility up top. And now it says in here they're selling them at the concession stands.
This would be for the one-day liquor license.
Yes.
I have been to functions where they have had the one-day liquor license, and they do sell it down there. They do wine and beer.
Downstairs. Okay, I've never seen it done.
No other alcohol, just that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
I mean, if there is, let us know, and we'll get a liquor license going for them.
No, I didn't think there's any liquor down there, mm-hmm. but I didn't think they were even serving beer only in the athletic club.
Mm-hmm.
That's I was under that impression.
Okay. And John, did you want to ask a question or
abstain from the water?
The water-related borrowing, the borrowing note?
Yes.
Okay. So motion made and seconded, no further questions, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'm going to vote no on the Mullen Center licenses.
Okay. Okay, we're going to move into public comment period, and then we have a few appointments this evening. But at the outset of public comment, just wanted to talk about a couple of items that came to the Select Board's attention. This week we received, I received an email from a citizen who was questioning the possibility of utilizing absentee voting for purposes of town meeting in a manner similar to the way that you would handle an election. You know, as we all know, when there's a presidential election or local election, you can request an absentee vote if you're not going to be in the area and vote in advance. I think this is a topic that's come up before, so we wanted to address the response to that tonight. And again, certainly we will be getting back directly to the individual who made the request. But in conference with David Nixon and also the town clerk, it may seem like a good thing to do because, as we all know, not everybody can make town meeting. It's on a set date. There are people that work Thursday evenings that can't get out of work. There are people who don't want to drive at night. There are a variety of reasons that people may not be able to attend town meeting. However, Massachusetts general law does not allow for that opportunity to have any sort of absentee voting. Town meeting is really under the control of the town moderator to hear comment and pros and cons. So, David, do you want to add anything to that? Or?
No, I think you summarized it as a proxy vote is not allowed by Mass General Law.
Right, so.
I'd like to add to it if I could, in my, as a moderator. At one point in time, it always comes up, this conversation always comes up regarding that issue. And basically what they're saying, a warrant is telling you that you're forewarned that this article is going to come up and it's going to be discussed. But that has nothing to do with the field discussion that can happen on the floor. And if you already have somebody committed one way or the other and something comes up that would hedge their vote to be something different, you have no way to check that. So it always is discussed that you just can't do it. That's why they don't do it.
And then secondly, there was another inquiry made of the Select Board that had to do with the Autobahn, which is the new raceway, indoor raceway, that has opened up recently at the Hampshire Mall. And the concern that was raised by a citizen anonymously, and I'm going to come back to the fact that it was anonymous in a moment, but the concern that was raised was they happened to see an advertisement on, I believe, Facebook or YouTube for the Audubon Raceway. And it was a short film clip. I did wind up viewing it this morning after becoming aware of it, that it was done to promote the raceway, the grand opening of the raceway. And it featured some of these go-karts. If you're familiar with the Autobahn, it's a go-kart facility located at the Hampshire Mall. And the promotional video was done in a humorous fashion, and it showed the go-karts getting out into the mall and then ultimately out into the parking lot. And in the course of the video, you do see that a Hadley police cruiser you catch sight of in the video, and you also see one of our Hadley fire trucks along with a gentleman dressed in Hadley fire gear participating in the video. So from the individual who witnessed it, the question arose, I think legitimately from their perspective, is this how we're utilizing town resources? Were these people being paid to promote a commercial enterprise? Are we using public dollars to support a commercial enterprise? So we did have discussion with both of our chiefs in that regard, and to put it in a different context, from the chief's perspective, they have been both working very hard to promote community outreach. And I think when they were asked to participate in this video, and I have to say, the police cruiser, it was the end of the officer's shift. He literally drove into the parking lot, was filmed, and went back to the station. And again, the fire truck was used for a very short amount of time. It was driven over for purposes of acting effectively as a prop and then brought back to the station. So both of our chiefs felt they did approve this use, and it was done in the context of promoting community outreach. We have done this type of thing before. I think if you've gone to Home Depot at different times of year, you'll see that the fire department and the like are out there. Obviously, our new police chief is doing far more in community outreach than I think, you know, we've experienced in the past, and trying to get people used to seeing the police department in a different capacity. So what it did raise, though, was a question of how do we, what sort of protocol should we have in place going forward to approve this kind of thing? So that's something that's in discussion now, whether or not that sort of initiative should be kind of kicked up to make sure that everybody's aware of it in advance and sign off on it. I shouldn't say everybody, but at least, you know, the town administrator and perhaps the select board. So we'll be discussing that, so we appreciate the fact that it was pointed to our attention. But at this point, you know, we feel that the question was asked and responded to. I don't think that the chiefs realized it was actually going to find its way into that sort of a video where it came across more as a commercial rather than a promotion of something good happening in the town of Hadley. Because we do appreciate our commercial district and the dollars of revenue that they bring into the town. I also just want to make comment that there were some other questions that arose in the context of the same inquiry, but the inquiry was of an anonymous nature, and I think we've mentioned this before that, you know, certainly if we hear something, we're going to respond to it, and there were some questions raised that we'll look into, but we can't react to everything that somebody puts in front of us that's done in an anonymous fashion. The individual who wrote the letter that I referred to before asking the question about town meeting provided all of their contact information, so it's very easy for us to either enter into a dialogue or get back to the individual. But when it's done anonymously, there's no way for us to find out more information, to ask questions, etc. So, you know, we're not going to respond to any anonymous inquiry, certainly at a public meeting. That said, you know, we're looking into other questions that arose in the context of that, but that is our policy and will continue to be our policy.
Can I make a quick comment about that, too?
Sure.
It's happening more and more because of the internet. If anybody watched the news last night for the Eastern States Exposition is having a fright night, so they made a simple video. And before they knew it, it went viral, and 1.5 million people viewed it. It was about a scary clown, and he had a sign, free hugs. But that's how the internet works. Now it can be picked it up, and bingo, 1 million people are looking at it. That's what we're confronted today with the internet.
Okay. John?
Yeah. I think if someone makes a complaint, they don't want to sign a name to it, or phone number or contact, that shouldn't even be broadcasted on the air, because you're going to be chasing ghosts all your life. If someone got a valid complaint, they should sign it, otherwise put in a trash can.
Yeah, and the only reason that we addressed the Autobahn issue is because it did find its way into the public domain. So from that regard, if one person saw it, many people saw it, and we thought it was worth just making it clear.
I think what these two chiefs doing, promoting both departments, is a great thing.
Mm-hmm.
Good for the community, good for the departments.
Okay. So we do have a 7:15 appointment, so I think we're just going to roll right into that. And our 7:15 appointment this evening happens to be a police appointment. So, Chief.
Hot seat. Very serious.
Who you have before you tonight is Officer Tom Hudak. We are a little short-handed right now. We can only get a couple of guys to come in. We have several people out with surgeries and injuries and stuff. So with Officer Schlosser resigning, we have selected Mr. Hudak here to be his replacement. He's not an additional officer. He's a replacement officer. We made it through our entire selection process, and that's why he is before you today. So I wrote a few things down about him. I'll tell you a little bit about him. Tom has been with us since 2014. He started as a special police officer for us. He simultaneously worked as a full-time officer at Mount Holyoke Police Department, where he just recently resigned for this position. Tom showed us from the start that his dream was to be a municipal police officer, to take nothing away from campus police. He has simply always wanted to work for a town department. He has continually put in time here and often gets out of work at the college at around 11 p.m. and will rush over here quickly and get dressed to start an overnight shift by about 11:15. He was promoted to one of our part-time positions in 2015, and he continued to show his dedication to us. Tom has shown that he can be trusted and is a quality police officer and person. I am recommending him to fill our vacant full-time position and be the newest full-time Hadley officer. The only caveat with this appointment is that the Academy Waiver Committee does not meet until November, which is the committee that would allow him to work full-time until the next available academy. Knowing this, Tom still resigned from his full-time job and is going to put in nearly full-time hours as a part-time officer and go on COBRA insurance if he has to, just to take this appointment today. I will work out all the details as far as when his start date would potentially be with the Treasurer's Department, but all of those things I want you to know about him, and he is my recommendation for our newest full-time officer.
Based on the recommendation of Chief Mason, I'd like to recommend and follow up that Thomas Hudak be promoted to a full-time patrolman in the town of Hadley.
I'll second that, and thank you for taking the jump into working full-time for us.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
Any questions for Mr. Hudak? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Welcome aboard. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, officers.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Are you all set?
I'm just going to take them downstairs and talk to them if you have nothing further for me.
No, we don't. Have,
seriously.
Have a very good evening.
Yeah. You
don't get on no go-karts.
All right. I'll stay off.
Thanks, Chief.
Okay.
Thank you.
Let's see. At 7:20, we have an appointment for the fire station. And this appointment, we invited Chief Spanknebel here tonight to talk about space needs, programming, and function of the fire department as they relate to the proposed North Hadley substation. And yeah, so do you want to start there? Where we're at right now is that there's a proposal on the table. There are actually three warrant articles related to North Hadley substation on the special town meeting. One is a petition article, and then there are two other articles related to it. This has been an ongoing dialogue with the select board. The select board several months ago formed an ad hoc committee chaired by John Michkowski Sr. And they have been studying the feasibility of building a substation on the lot adjacent to North Hadley Hall, which town meeting voted to put up for sale at the last town meeting? Fall town meeting?
Two town meetings.
Two town meetings ago. Right. So, and then we have an offer to purchase on that property. But in the meantime, the subcommittee has spent a fair amount of time evaluating, again, the feasibility of putting up a substation that meets the needs of the fire department on the lot adjacent to North Hadley Hall. So, and just in terms of where that subcommittee stands right now, there wasn't an initial proposal of a building of fairly significant size that was built, I think, with a strong view of the future possible needs for the town of Hadley. But we have also asked the chief to address the immediate needs, because when this all started, I think the impetus was the fact that North Hadley Hall was going to be potentially sold, and when it's sold, clearly right now we're using that facility to house a couple of fire trucks. There's a new fire truck on order that should be arriving in
3 weeks.
3 weeks. That fire truck is too large to fit in that station, and we need to figure out the adequacy of storage for the equipment that we're about to have in 3 weeks. So there are a lot of moving parts here. There have been an awful lot of questions about whether or not we need a substation the size of the one initially proposed. My understanding is I think the subcommittee's actually reworked that and may have an alternate design that they're working on currently. But in the meantime, I always like to separate fact from fiction, and thought it would be wise to have Chief Spanknebel himself come in tonight so that any questions that we have can be addressed by Mike. Okay, so that's the plan for the discussion.
Okay. Thank you. First off, I'd like to say thank you to Johnny for, he's done an enormous amount of work on this project. Mr. Pipchinski as well, they've traveled to, I don't know how many fire stations, substations, looking, getting information, bringing information back to the committee. Mike Mason and I were asked to be as advisory to this, so yes, we've done a lot of work on it, both Mike and I and the committee. So I was asked to come in tonight about the space needs, I'm assuming present and future. So at present, we have the North Hadley Fire Station as it sits, which has been an issue for a number of years, which was actually, it was put into capital when we first presented that we needed a new rescue pumper to build that station out, with anticipation of having to move our pumper that we have in our center station up to that location. So that was put in at the time that truck actually at first went in. So when the truck was, the town decided to order the truck because it seemed to just keep going and going, and we're going on, I think, 3 years since we ordered, since the truck was approved. It takes over a year for the engineering and build out, the training and everything else. So in order to keep going with our maintenance of our fleet and what we're looking to replace, it was critical that we keep moving with bringing that pumper in. So for the short term, we understand that there is a proposal for the North Hadley station to be sold. However, we're looking at, can we remain there short term until we can figure out what's going to happen with this bigger plan that the ad hoc committee, that the municipal building committee, that the OPM has reviewed now and requested information from myself and from, I believe, both the committees. So looking at it now, we do have the ability to remain in that station by removing some of the older equipment that we have stored in there right now, and then doing some simple adjustments to the doors, the oil tank, the generator, and some other equipment in there, and then attempting to weatherproof the building a bit better, because we use an awful lot of heat to keep that truck at, you know, at 50 degrees. So that proposal was put in as part of the capital plan. It was, I believe, $5,000 or $5,500 to do that build out. That would be a short-term fix, with the understanding that we were going to be able to find some type of storage somewhere else to be able to alleviate the center station burden and the North Hadley burden. So that's what we have on the short term. So I don't know if you have any questions on that first portion.
Yeah, in the first portion, the space needs for equipment, one of the questions that has come up a handful of times has to do with the number of pieces of equipment that we have. So clearly, you know, your pumpers and everything, obviously those are primary. You know, your command vehicle, your rescue vehicle. But there's also, I believe there's an antique fire truck. There may be some other, like the brush truck, some pieces of equipment that aren't used frequently. So one of the questions that has arisen in people's minds is there any way to either downsize the amount of equipment that we're holding, or take the equipment that is used quite infrequently and remove it from Central Station so that...
So they're basically, the rescue pumper that's coming in was put together to handle two vehicles. Mm-hmm. So we are going to be eliminating a 1987 bread van that we received for free from the town of Amherst. So that is going to absorb two vehicles. However, we're talking about a truck that is very specialized and requires extensive training, and we're also driving a very extremely, you know, this is a heavy truck. So we also need the ability to have some of our younger firefighters and some of our less experienced firefighters that can still operate some smaller equipment that can get to a scene of a motor vehicle accident like this truck, this bread truck did, this rescue truck. So we received from the town of Ware, and you've seen it parked out in the driveway right now, a free vehicle that was under the state DCR program that we get a lot of our equipment from, that we've gotten equipment for the DPW. And that truck is in extremely good condition. So with minimal money, we're going to be, out of my budget, fixing that vehicle up as a light rescue that can handle that initial light response, which will also take a burden off of the number of miles that we're putting on our new pumper and then our existing engine 3 that will be moving north. Those trucks go out a lot, so I'm looking at it in that way. The brush truck that we have, it's a 1952 that has been scheduled and requested for replacement for a long time. It is definitely time for it to go. We are working on that. It's in capital. But it's not something that can just be stored out in an open barn or something that's not heated. It's got a water tank on it. And I can't tell you when a brush fire is going to happen. With the season we had this year, I know we've started to get some rain, but we're nowhere near where we need to be for how dry it is with the litter that's coming down off the trees now. So I can't tell you if that truck's going to need to go out this fall. So not really an option to remove that and put it somewhere. Same thing with our tanker truck. The tanker truck that's being completed under capital requests that we received funding for, another free vehicle that we got, it's a 2010 AM General that the DPW is working on. That truck is about to roll out and take the place of our 1972. So that truck is essential not only for brush fire season, but also for areas of town where we don't have hydrants, which we do still have some areas, that we may need to start with a tanker operation. So that truck needs to stay. The rescue boat is another piece of equipment that needs to stay in the center station, because I can't tell you if something's going to happen early spring, late fall, on the river where we need to be out there. Even the fact that that boat used to go out to examine the dike in the fall time to make sure to see what was going on the riverside. So we used to do that inspection once a year, which we probably need to do again. So that,
you need to keep that inside, Michael?
Yes, that needs to be kept
Why?
Inside. Because it needs to be able to drive out and get dumped in the river and be warm and ready to go. So not an option to be winterized and left outside with the equipment on it as well. I mean, we have radios on it. We have our, you know, life jackets, first aid kit, all that stuff. So those, in all honesty, with removing the 1926 REO Speedwagon, which is an important piece to the town, with removing that and getting some of the emergency management supplies out that will be going into the trailer, I think we'll be okay at the center station right now for the short term. The other issue is that our engine 2, our 1987 Pierce, which this new pumper is going to be replacing, needs to remain as a spare for at least the first 6 months of operation with this new pumper.
As a training tool?
While we're training the new truck. Yeah. And then, if there's any glitches on this new truck, this thing is extremely sophisticated. And also, you know, this 87 Pierce, it's a very strong truck. I can't tell you, the tank is in rough shape, and it doesn't have the modern safety. It's not an enclosed cab, which are all NFPA standards now. But it is a strong truck that we can use as a spare when we have to ship a truck down for maintenance down to Connecticut or out to near Boston. So it's an option for us to have as a backup right now. Should we evaluate that after 6 months of having that new truck in place? Absolutely, because if the cost of maintaining it is exceeding its use, then we're going to need to ship it down the road. And But that's something that we'll evaluate as we go.
So what exactly is going, so once the new truck arrives in 3 weeks, what exactly is to be housed in North Hadley?
So North Hadley will take our 2006 pumper, which is in Center Station right now.
Yep.
That's our second, our newest truck now, minus the new one that's coming.
Yep.
So that truck, that's the standard of how we normally do it, is we take the newest truck, comes into Center Station, and then the second in line in age moves up to North Station. Mm-hmm. So that's why we need to raise the door heights a little bit. We need to clean out the back of it because the truck's a bit longer and a bit higher. So we're squished in there, as you can see already, but we can make it work. So that truck will stay there, and right now, because of the bridge being out, we have our mini pumper, 1962 mini pumper, is at our Center Station because that truck can go over the bridge and we can establish a water supply and start doing fire operations with that mini pumper right across the bridge. That's why we moved that down here right now. So that will stay until the bridge issue is taken care of. So the brush truck is going to remain up north, and then we will have a little bit of relief there for, there's just so little space there right now. And then we do have the upstairs. However, the upstairs has been pretty much decommissioned at this point. The water's off. We do have a kitchen up there, but because of the water break we had two winters ago, that's all has been shut off at this time.
And again, the whole point of having North Station is to support a call force where the expectation is that some members of the call force are more proximate to the North Station than they are to Central Station?
Correct. Actually, it's kind of interesting because it's very ironic that Myron Chudzik actually did a station location review prior to the build-out of 1996 and of the Center Station. And it's everything that's in this, and I just got this from him, and there's so many similarities to what we're presenting now. He did an extensive review, even drawing out by hand the maps of Hadley and how they laid out the 4 mile, 5 mile radius for response by vehicles for where we were going to be building the new Central Station. And then the percentage of the community that station would cover at 4 miles and 5 miles. So a lot of this information that's in here is a very similar statement to what is in our 5-year phase plan, the North Hadley Fire Station review, and it was pretty interesting to find this. And I can tell you that until the town of Hadley decides to bring on full-time staffing, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, and you know, even after that, we will always be supported by a call force department. I can't tell you next year how many people are going to be living north of Huntington Road. We may have 15 call force firefighters that decide that they're going to purchase a house up there, and that's the purpose of that. We are allowing these guys who, you know, these men and women who are giving their time to get to the station quickly, get their gear on, and then go with the truck. And I can tell you with all the data that we've collected, driving the, you know, the roads to see this, there's a substantial time difference if we don't have that. The second thing I want to add to it is that hypothetically, we have call force people show up to our Center Station during the day or at night, and there's only two. Two firefighters is not enough to start an attack on a structure fire, and it's not enough to even handle, you know, a motor vehicle accident with multiple injuries and entrapment. So for us to take that North Station away and require those gentlemen from North Hadley to come down, regardless of whether they make the first truck, you're still talking at double the time for them to come down, get geared up, and then get the truck back to where it's gotta be, rather than just stopping in North Hadley and going. So my opinion, I've been hired as the fire chief to do risk analysis, to do pre-planning, to evaluate the needs of the community and what I think that we need for proper protection and safety of our residents. John's been on the department for a long time and he knows the fires that we've had up north. I've spent a lot of time reading the history of Hadley, and I can tell you there have been some, and I'm sure Donald can attest to this, there have been a lot of very serious fires up there, And the biggest thing that I notice when I read all those historical documents is that the town of North Hadley, the village, always was coming together with bucket brigades and ringing bells and getting there, and not so much to save the house, but to save what was in it. And that's the mentality of the guys and gals that we have up in North Hadley. They want to get there quick, and they want to be able to help. So I think it's really important that we keep that in mind when we're making a decision on what we need for a station there. So I've always maintained that we need a space to store a minimum of two trucks. So in light of that, now we're looking down the road another 15 years, 20 years. So hypothetically, we're moving towards a full-time fire department. And again, we don't want to be in the position where we're coming back to the town again to say, oops, you know, we didn't make this big enough. Things have changed. Our senior population has increased, which I've certainly heard multiple times now. Our ambulance service, you know, if that comes down the road and we need additional space for a second, a third ambulance, that's what we're looking at when we're putting together this proposal for this north station. So the original proposal was the 100 by 65 foot structure. And that was put together by the committee as a way to maximize the space. So when Mike Mason and I were tasked with evaluating that, we evaluated it for both police and for fire. And you see what the number is, and it's, you know, it's a large number. So as a chief looking at that number, I say to myself, what are the bare minimum needs that we, you know, that I feel that we should be looking at so that everybody has all the information down the road? And that's why we came back and we put together a second plan, which is 65 by 80. So that allows for two bays, and it's about a truck and a half deep. It allows for a backup dispatch center. And I made some copies of, hopefully you can read a little bit.
And is this what you discussed with the OPM, Mike?
This is what, actually the OPM has a different philosophy when they're doing their reviews of this. Mm-hmm. So if you want, Johnny can tell you what he spoke with the OPM about. The OPM mandated and reeled me in completely on that he only wanted to hear what the spatial requirements were that I felt were critical to the fire department.
Right, and that's, I understand it's not necessarily the recommendation of the OPM, right. But this is the information you provided to the OPM.
That's the information
this is what I have to have, if nothing else. Okay.
This is projecting, again, we're talking about needs today and needs for the future. So you can see there's really nothing, it's scaled down and it's very, there's no fluff in it. So we have the ability to park our trucks, we have the ability to have a backup dispatch center, we have a meeting room and kitchen. The discussions that came back with the OPM was the potential need for space to house people if there was an incident. So being able to pull the trucks out and using the bay as a shelter type situation. We have emergency generator proposed. We have showers, and we designed it because all the modern firefighting information that's coming out now, and it's extremely scary, is that 1 in 3 firefighters are going to be diagnosed with some type of cancer as a result of what they're doing. So the state is really pushing information out in a real high rate because we need to change our philosophy and attitude of how we're bringing new people into the fire service and how we're making sure that they are taking care of themselves and their turnout gear and equipment so that they're not completely messing themselves up. So that's why we also put in, you know, a washer and dryer, and then the ability for folks to actually take a shower. The North Hadley station at this time has no possibility to take a shower in it. So you have guys that are coming home from extremely nasty fires, and it's not the woolen, solid wood fires of the past. It is now carcinogens, plastics, and everything nasty that you can think of that these guys are getting exposed to. And so that's the other reason why we designed that like that, so we can start taking care of the men and women who are giving a lot of their time to do all this. So for that's for the future. So we have the ability to expand out with that in the event of an ambulance. Yeah. We have the ability to, we propose two bunk rooms for that space, that if down the road we needed to staff that with an ambulance, we would have the ability to do that. And we've also proposed a mezzanine above the office space so that we can maybe lighten the load of both police and fire for incidental storage that we have in our center station for records, and other stuff that we don't have any storage in the center station as it is now. So that's why we proposed that as well.
And so, just to clarify for people too, when you're talking about moving to a full-time fire force, the last conversation you had with the select board, talking about the SAFER grant,
correct,
we're looking at a 3-year at the earliest time horizon for that. But even in that context, when you were talking full-time, you were talking a full-time daytime fire force. So the call force would still exist.
Absolutely.
In the evening hours.
That's one thing that everybody has to understand, and it's one thing that I've been getting a lot of questions on, is the concept of mutual aid versus the concept of all of our surrounding communities are just going to come and show up to all the fires, and we're not going to have to worry about it because Amherst is going to come, Northampton's going to come. I can tell you all that the way mutual aid is set up is that when we run out of resources at an incident, that's when we're calling for mutual aid for assistance from our neighbors. There's no way that Amherst can handle sending an engine over for every car accident, every structure fire, before we use our own resources to go there and actually make sure that there's a structure fire happening, or that it's one that's big enough that we would need them to come. You can read the local, the union, the Amherst Union, their firefighters union. They have a Facebook page that has countless times where they have nobody left in their station. The fire chief, Chief Nelson, has applied for a SAFER grant himself because the staffing is just, they can't maintain anymore. So we have Northampton. Northampton's going through the same growing pains. Sunderland actually reduced from having a full-time fire officer to not having one now. So, you know, they have limited resources for us. And the same with South Hadley. Everybody's feeling the crunch. But with the way Hadley has grown and the hazards that we have in our community and the number of calls that we're responding to, it's time, and that's why we put together that 5-year phase plan. So the first phase, we're at 0.5 of phase one with applying for the SAFER grant, and we're hoping that that will happen. That will bring on board 4 full-time day staff, and with the hopes that after 2 years, we'll be able to roll in the ability to support full-time staffing with, you know, with an ambulance service. So we're looking to make sure that we're preparing for that future. So we have a center station right now that is not built out with bunk rooms. We are at max capacity, and so that's the other concern, is we're looking at a North Hadley substation, but we also need things to be done at our center station. So that's why we were working so hard to try and figure out if there's a way we could somehow combine both and make it reasonable. And that's why we've really pared it down, and for this future proposal. So that's what I have so far. Obviously, a lot hinges on the SAFER grant, because if we are not lucky enough, because it is so competitive, you know, the town really needs to make a decision on what they feel. Your board needs to decide what is an acceptable level of risk for their residents. So,
Johnny, I got a question for you. You're 65 deep, and you dropped 20 feet. Did you drop the 20 feet on the apparatus side or on the office side? On the office side?
Correct. Yep.
It used to be 100 this way.
Why would you shortchange yourself on the office side?
You know, because, let me answer that. Because one of your selectmen asked about it was too big. So it's still, the committee did not give a final vote to this. We're just looking at all aspects of this. So we went to the chief, and he downsized this, okay? We have to look at the cost is one thing, but the needs and the future needs, that's what has to be determined, you know.
Why I'm asking this question is, I've asked this question for 4 years now since I've been on the board, and Mike's heard it 100 times already from me. In a life or death situation for our community right now, we're on our own. If this hurricane comes up and takes half the town out, we are not prepared for our center station to be leveled. And why would you shortchange yourself 20 feet in dispatch, in all kinds of access here, as a secondary operation?
We were asked by your board.
I understand that, but this is the question I've been asking for 4 years. I just want to confirm what's going on here.
Johnny.
Go ahead, Mike.
I can say I understand that. Mike Mace and I met specifically on that exact issue.
Yeah.
And we felt that the need for what was eliminated was the Sally Port and some additional office area for them to work out of. What we decided was that in an effort to try and keep an open mind on the center station needs as well, that we could still easily share with the way we did not shrink the size of the dispatch center, and we still left it so it's expandable in the kitchen, day room, the meeting room, and then the mezzanine area, so that if we needed to have, hypothetically, something happens to the center station, we would be able to bring police resources up there and operate.
Again, we made it fit at the time, just like we built the center station. Now we're making this fit again, and if another 20 feet and another $400,000 or $500,000 at this point, it's pretty minimal over 50 or 100 years.
I think most people, John, to directly answer your question, I'm probably the one who said about getting it smaller as well, too, is that many people in this town don't feel you need two full dispatches in this town, that they feel you need a substation up there to be able to accommodate an office, storage, utility room, and the trucks that you need up there, not a full station. This town, people don't feel, my humble opinion, that we need two full stations in the town of Hadley. So, and that was my point to Michael and my point to Johnny and to the committee. So that's what I'm hearing when people are talking to me, that you're building a bigger station there. The people want the station in center of town to be fixed and done right the way it needs to be done to address the issues that Michael has pointed out to us that need to be done, and Johnny as well. But not to have two full stations in this town. There's 5,000 people in this town, and you can't financially pay for two full stations.
But just to intervene on that also is that there's always been a communication availability to us in North Hadley. It may not have been used, but the idea was that somehow something got knocked out in the center of town, that they would have another area to have a dispatch area.
Yeah.
And that's the only reason that they're putting in. I mean, it's not going to be used on a daily basis at this point.
It's only on a small scale right now, what they do use up there.
Yes.
But, like I said, the federal government doesn't have this equipment waiting for us in a natural disaster. And if something does happen, we are not prepared for this.
I think that towns the size of Hadley, I'll be very surprised if you find two full stations in any town the size of Hadley.
Mike, you're in the civil defense now after I left and after the past chiefs left. And we've been talking about this for 30 years.
Well, shouldn't we be talking about a regional approach? Because if you have an incident, you don't necessarily want to set up your redundant system 2 miles down the road. You want to have a regional failover system that's nowhere near here.
But we also have generators at both schools. I mean, so we're not without some place for somebody to go without generators being available to some of our needs that we might have if we do have a disaster.
They
don't qualify because they don't run the whole school.
They don't qualify.
But that's...
That's a bully.
Yeah.
So, just to say, I mean, we've talked about regionalization, and I get it. Mm-hmm. My concern is, and one of the reasons why it was designed this way, is I've talked with you, Molly, before about why are we looking to regionalize outside of Hadley? Why aren't we looking at being the regional center for everybody? So that we're, again, not paying out to somebody, but we are bringing in. And that's, you know, again, this is expandable. We have two sites right now at our center station, and the ability to put a third here. Is that enough? I don't know. But looking at the different possibilities for a regional center, you know, perhaps Hadley could be that regional center.
Sure, but you need willing participants in it.
Correct.
The same way Hadley hasn't been willing to, you know, look externally. Mm-hmm. But yeah, ma'am, and you know full well, when we talk about regionalization, we're not presuming external versus internal. More than happy to be the host. Mm-hmm. But that's the question, is it? But you don't necessarily, I think to Jerry's point, sorry, we don't necessarily build it now, you know, but the fact that it is expandable would be critical, and that's what Mike's telling us. So that should that come to fruition and be a viable option down the road, we could work with that.
I understand how people look at something as if it's sitting there and it's not in operation. The way I look at it and the way John's looking at it is I can't tell you if tomorrow something really bad's going to happen. We have a new LNG facility that's about to fire up in another few weeks.
In Waitley?
In Hadley.
Oh, in Hadley. Okay.
At the university. Yeah. And the amount of business that's built up. I mean, we are kind of we're quite the epicenter here of a lot of stuff, a lot of real nasty stuff. Mm-hmm. And, you know, again, I have to look at it, and I completely understand how the people are looking at it, and I've been hearing it both ways. Mm-hmm. A lot of people are in support of it and feel that, you know, North Hadley deserves that with the amount of residential that's going up there. You know, I was actually asked when I first became chief from the state hazmat team if there was any chance we could park the state hazmat truck in our station, because every other department around us is giving up space to support us with regional assets. And there's no more room for anybody else to hold it. So they asked us, and I said, if you don't mind parking it outside, that's fine. But no, so we're looking at it as being a good neighbor as well, because there's potential regional assets that could be placed that would be very important to the town of Hadley if there was an incident.
Can I make a comment? I'm not a voting member on the ad hoc committee, but when we were first charged, we asked the fire chief and the police chief what their request was. And I think that's where the idea came about when the police got involved. And I agree with Mr. Devine, it gave the look of a second safety complex, which it wasn't intended to be. But now it can become the civil defense building for the town. It could be a heating and cooling center for the future, which the school can't provide like this building can. A little history here, too, about that site. The first truck that came to North Hadley came in 1959. It was a Diamond T truck. And the reason why I know, I was 10 years old, and it was parked in our hay barn behind our house. And then my father built an automobile garage in 62. The assistant fire chief worked for him, and there was a fire phone in there, and I knew every time that rang, something important was happening in town. He would drop everything he was doing, run to the backyard, grab that truck, and go. In 1963, the old Hook and Ladder Volunteer Fire Department decided that they were going to build a station across the street, all basically with volunteer help. And so it's existed there. The neighbors are aware of it. They like the location. And it has served this town well for 53 years. And it's a great location for that substation.
Johnny?
You know, I toured probably close to 20 fire departments. And in detail, Donald accompanied me to a lot of those visits. And a lot of the stations, when they were built, they're just looking at the dollar, not at 20 years down the road. Again, I served on that committee that did the safety complex. I was totally against what they did back then, and when they occupied it, I told them before the thing was even built, it's going to be to capacity. When they occupied it, it's going to be to capacity. It was. And here we're stuck with it. Other towns, the same thing has happened. Then they have a phase built. The next phase never comes. And every department we did, I took pictures of every single station, their cubbyhole, their attics, their storage. Everything is chock full. This department we have here now, go there. Go to North Hadley. There's no room, police. There's no room for evidence. There's no room for records. There's no room for things that you need to put undercover in a locked door. All his equipment, it can be out in the sun. You can't expose that equipment. And the dangers that these guys face today are worse than ever. They need protection for their gear, like he said, with cancer. It's a serious thing. And it's not just here in Hadley. Every station, every chief, every deputy chief we talk to rattles the same tone. And it's a needed thing. It has to happen. It's for life and property protection. This station, what we have here, yes, in the future, that's going to be adjusted as time goes on. But show me one department in this town that hasn't expanded and hasn't all the pressure on every single department we have, even as the Board of Selectmen. There's more pressure on your board.
Past their capacities all the time.
Right, exactly. It doesn't get less. It gets more, and it's more complicated. And it's greater risk.
So, and again, Megan, I know you've said this before, but just for the record, because we get questions. So as far as you're concerned, your number one priority is clearly staffing. That's the reason we already applied for the SAFER grant. We're keeping our fingers crossed.
Correct.
May or may not come to fruition. If it doesn't come to fruition, you're going to continue to beat the drum to get the staffing. That staffing would affect Central Station primarily.
Correct.
But again, the call force is here to stay, at least for the foreseeable future.
Correct.
Okay. Anybody have any questions for other questions for Mike?
I do have one other
sure.
thing for
yeah.
you. I was asked to attempt to find some storage options.
Yes.
So I've been in discussions with the Hampshire Mall. We have a cache of emergency management supplies, regional emergency management supplies that are under control of the town of Hadley. And they are willing to sit down and discuss the potential of moving that REO speed wagon and a bunch of other stuff, including that hose wagon, into that space for us.
Is that called a speed wagon?
Yes.
I know it's called a REO, but I never heard it called REO speed wagon.
It's there. It's an
REO.
He thinks
it's just an old rock
speed. That was the first mover in the town of Hadley.
First mover in Hadley.
I'm sorry, I apologize.
And it's not just a band.
Yeah. Okay.
So where are they going to put it in over there, Mike?
So on the back side of the mall next to Target, you have Joann's Fabrics.
Yep.
There is an empty space there that the mall has been kind enough to allow us to store for free for the past, I'd say, 3 or 4 years. We have enough regional shelter supplies there to take care of over 100 people. And that equipment is coming in and going out all the time for incidents, for trainings, and they've been very gracious to give us free space there. So we're going to sit down and discuss if that can continue.
And I'm assuming it has a bay that you'd be able to get.
Basically what it has a double door. So what we would be doing is the only cost that I could see would be we have to replace the door on it because it's beat. And potentially we may have to widen it a little bit. But I think we can get the equipment that we have in there. And if that's the case, that's going to take care of our immediate need at Center Station to move our boat, adjust our boat, and get that engine that we're keeping on the back side of the station and hopefully keep us going. But I just need direction on the North Hadley situation. So if we're staying in North Hadley for right now, that's fine, but we just need to pull the trigger on getting some short-term stuff done up there so that we can get that engine 3 into that bay. And you know, it's not big dollars. I think it's something that's doable this year.
That's the $5,500 build out you were talking about earlier.
Correct. That's based upon an estimate to raise the door up a little bit, or the frame of the door, and to move the oil tank. Potentially, we're making sure we have the proper measurements to see if we have to lift the one heater that we have in there, and we have a generator that's on the floor there too that we're going to have to move, which should go where that hose wagon if we move that out.
Mm-hmm.
So.
So how do we allocate that money for him?
Does the West Farm want their hose wagon back?
I could take him out of building maintenance.
Yeah, I mean, it's
I think we need to do that before winter flies here. You can't be sitting on this. You got a truck coming in 3 weeks, so.
You're talking about
I don't see any reason not to.
55 is modifications to North Hadley Village Hall.
Yep, that was put into capital, and I think David has an answer for that.
Well, I'd like to make a motion to allocate that $5,500 to adjust the building up in North Hadley to be able to fit your apparatus in there.
Second for discussion.
Okay, I guess my question is, we're still involved with the sale of North Hadley Hall, and how will that play in? Will we still be in good faith negotiating if we do something like this?
Well, I guess it depends on what you intend to do after December 31st. We have a budget to carry the maintenance, the operations of that building only so far, with an eye towards selling it, which you've taken a vote that that's what you want to do. So are we modifying a building that we're going to hand over to somebody else in the next couple of months?
I guess my question
That's a decision for the select board as to what you want to do.
Has Mr. Greenbaum given you more information recently? He's no longer interested in the hall, or has he walked away from the agreement? I guess that's what I'm looking for.
No, he has expressed an interest in going through with the purchase of the property, and he's redesigned some of his ideas about what to do with the property. So he's still very much interested in acquiring the property.
Okay, so we could do this in the interim and still be in agreement with Mr. Greenbaum?
Right, that'll carry you for a couple of months.
Right, it's a couple of months proposition.
Only a couple of months?
Well, potentially longer, but I mean, at least.
What do you want to do with
the
building?
Well, we have to see what's going to happen at town meeting this month.
Yeah, this all hinges on town meeting.
This is going to tell the story this month, so.
You just made a motion to spend money.
Huh?
You just made a motion to spend some money.
I am going to spend some money. You got to put some, you got to put that truck someplace.
Good. I'll tell you.
We've been sitting around on this thing for too long now, and I'm getting a little bit tired of it.
Yeah, so just walk through that one again. So the Hampshire Mall itself doesn't require any modification? I thought you were saying that we needed to modify the door at the Hampshire.
We do, but I hope that I can possibly cover that door with my own budget.
Okay, so the 5,500 had nothing to do with the Hampshire Mall.
The 5,500 was strictly just for the North Hadley modifications to be able to pack in our engine 3 in there.
Is there any other alternative?
I believe, David, we had talked about that potential site in North Hadley. I don't know if that's...
Right, so Mr. Rabine and I had a conversation. We agreed that we would meet to talk about it. He's still very much interested in helping out the town, so mm-hmm. We have that other option that's on the table as well.
So you still have to do rent.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, so my question is, if in fact... How do you pronounce his name again?
Rabine.
If Mr. Rabine could accommodate, okay, and you had to compare the choice of paying $5,500 and modifying the doorway, knowing what you know about the potential facility that Mr. Rabine might have, and assuming both scenarios are relatively short term until we know with more clarity what's going to happen going forward, is one better than the other by any degree of significance?
I don't know if things have changed with Mr. Rabine as far as the plan of what he was deciding to build out there.
Right,
yeah,
so just assuming.
He scaled it way back.
Okay, so we had scaled it strictly to handle two trucks. So if it's changed and it's scaled way back, I would have to take a look and see what it is, because we might be going into a space that we're not going to fit into. So.
Right.
But, I mean, it's certainly something to investigate, and it's certainly something that we could absolutely take advantage of if the space is there.
Right,
let's
say he offered up tomorrow and said, you know what, for, you know, consideration of a dollar, I'll let you use the space on a short-term basis until you get this figured out.
There's no Easter Bunny.
That's really good bargain, because the last time I heard it was $5,000 a month. To go to a dollar is a far cry.
Well, the $5,000 a month was a complete build-out. Yeah. We discussed that at the last meeting, so that's off the table. So I'm just questioning.
Absolutely.
I'm certainly in favor of making a decision to do something once and for all. But I'm wondering if the $5,500 to modify North Hadley temporarily should be contingent on additional discussion with Mr. Rabin.
And that would be fine too. I would like to have something in place. I would like somebody to have some discussion this week with Mr. Rabin to find out what he wants to do, but we need to move forward. So if I need to readjust my motion saying contingent on an alternative plan, but whatever, but I want that money available to be used and get started on.
Were there any tentative figures discussed by him for the quick?
$5,000 a month.
No, total build out. But he's talking about now going in there quickly. Is it $500 a month? $1,000 a month?
No, we haven't had that conversation.
Didn't give you any inclination.
No.
But you know, $5,000 total build out, and if we go up there for $500 a month, we're going to chew up the $5,000 we put into North Hadley Hall very quickly.
Did you just say $5,000 a month for rent?
The full build-out.
No, that was going to be the permanent solution. And I'm just saying, and then we have to look at taxpayers in the eye to say we're potentially putting $5,500 into a building that we're about to turn over to somebody else as well. So,
or tear down.
Yeah,
or tear down,
that.
Yeah. So
what are you going to do with this new fire truck? Park it outside?
We're reacting to what the chief is telling us. So I would just like to have that other piece of information, David.
All right, so we have the $5,500. We can find that out of building maintenance.
Yep.
Okay, so you don't need to appropriate that money. But certainly the chief and I are looking for instructions as to which way are we going to go.
Right.
Right.
And we don't know what Mr. Rabin might have to offer. That was just my question. And the chief is telling us that
it may be adequate. And we don't know what's happening at town meeting that will tell the tale of the whole story. So we still have to do something.
Right. So you've got a motion to go ahead and spend the $5,500. I'm just questioning whether or not we want that other piece of information as well before we make that decision. But I agree with you, if Mr. Rabin doesn't work out, then I would agree with spending the $5,500.
Well, can we do it on contingent then?
That's my request, I suppose. The pleasure of the board.
You know, and I would keep it in the negotiations if you sell the building still after town meeting vote, where if you're going to do that build out, we'd stay there a little longer.
To me, that doesn't make any sense. If the fire chief says that truck could be here in 3 weeks, we have to react now.
Well, we are.
You know, and he has to begin modifying that building immediately so that truck can get in there.
So the motion on the floor would be to allocate, have the money available to be allocated once we understand Mr. Rabin's suggestion. Is that the motion?
That's the motion.
And so it's a friendly amendment. You're making amendment.
I'm making a friendly amendment.
I think we have to rescind.
I'm not sure how friendly it is, but I'm making an amendment.
I will second the friendly amendment.
Okay, and people done with discussion, ready to vote on the motion made and seconded?
Yeah.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
David, can you expedite that?
Mm-hmm. And as far as the mall is concerned, if there is a cost associated, I'll come back to you and let you know, but they're going to do everything they can to help us out.
All right, and when you're talking to them, thank you. We're actually, we have a 7:30 appointment that we're quite late for.
Two questions found at ad hoc committee.
Okay, go ahead.
The first one, I would like you guys to appoint Eddie Dukiewicz on that committee. There's one other member that's not attending any meetings, and he's a civil defense director, and we really need his input in the station. And I asked him if he would serve and help us out. He said absolutely.
Did he submit anything in writing?
No.
And who is he replacing? Is he replacing somebody?
You don't have to replace anybody. He's Howard Koski. He hasn't been attending, but he just had another member that could add some valuable input to this committee.
Okay.
Where we need it before town meeting.
Well, couldn't he, does he have to be a member of the committee? Can't he just provide input?
Well, is it harmful that you appoint him to so he would?
Our policy, we went through this before, we need, if somebody wants to be on a committee, they themselves need to make the request, not
And I did ask to get on the agenda to find out if this Board of Selectmen, in fact, does support this for town meeting, or is it just a big question mark?
Right, and that's we're not discussing that on the agenda tonight. I mean, the point was to get more information.
But I asked Mr. Nixon to be put on the agenda for that particular thing, and somehow it was overlooked, or it was scrapped, or what happened?
No, I think that we put Mike on the agenda this evening so that we could have this
discussion.
But
I asked to get on it.
Okay. Do you want
to? So you asked me, I asked, we decided that was not going to work out so well, so I informed you we weren't going to be on the agenda.
When will it work out well? After town meeting?
Are you requesting to be on next week's agenda?
We don't have a meeting next week.
Oh, whatever the next meeting
is. Yes, you do.
Yeah, we have the next week.
I don't think so.
When's our OPM information coming
if,
back?
If Mr. Dukevich submits an application to be on the committee, we would take a vote on it.
We'll take a vote then.
Yeah, so that's just normal. Everybody has to go through that process.
I would just like an odd number, I mean, so that the votes can be taken. I always like an odd number.
I don't even know what the number is.
It must be an odd number.
Could he be an alternate? If somebody doesn't show up, then he's the alternate.
Well, why don't we just have him submit and do it formally the way we need to next week's meeting?
Stage of the game, I'll take anything.
Okay. All right.
I'll make a motion to.
No, there's no motion needed.
There's no motion.
It's just going to be on the agenda.
Why not? Why? She's a sergeant. She can't make a motion.
We're going to. He has to submit the letter. Okay. DPW, we had a 7:30 appointment. We're a tad bit late for. So, Marlo?
He's very patient.
Yes.
And he's having a few chuckles.
Yes, I am.
I owe him so much.
Okay, let's keep it going.
Well, I'm here tonight because I sent the memo along with two job descriptions to the board, I believe last week, time frame. As we all know, Mr. Klamowski will be retiring at the end of the month. So I started looking at what the DPW as a department maybe should look like going forward. I took many things into account when I started looking at this, just a little bit of a segue to how I arrived at the memo and the job descriptions. I think a big part of it was looking at the SWOT analysis, word for word, more than once. That had a lot of good information in it. I've been here 7 months now, believe it or not. I've got to see a lot of things, a lot of the operations go on within the department. Got to oversee a water project. So when I arrived at rewriting the job description, I also looked at how the DPW was voted in 2009 when it was brought together. It stated in there that when this position was going to be vacated, that another potentially another foreman would be hired in its place. So I named the job description one thing, but technically what this job is another foreman, but a lead foreman, so to speak. So I looked at different things that went on this summer, how we saved money by going through the SWOT analysis. You know, I know we're short on help here, we potentially are short here, but I wanted to look at what we could do better in-house to get the best out of the staffing that we have as far as efficiency and workload. Some of this came about this summer with Route 9 project. Just a quick little segue, we're at about $180,000 total for that project. It's complete. So I had to oversee a lot of that project out here due to the fact that the engineering firm couldn't provide an engineer for a lot of that project. So I plugged myself in. So coupled with the SWOT analysis and everything that's come about, it kind of triggered this thing to me saying, okay, we pay a lot. I started looking at engineering fees when we pay out to engineering firms. We need engineering firms. We don't have an engineering department. But what I was looking at is these smaller projects. Route 9 wasn't a small project. We had another project this summer, Russellville Culver stabilization. We saved $2,500 for a one-day repair there and engineering fees. So it triggered how I looked at this next position and coupled with my position on how they work together. In the grand scheme of things, it is the numbers of approximately $35,000 we've saved this summer on engineering fees. But between myself and Mr. Klamowski oversaw a couple small projects also, from the engineering inspection standpoint, not design and all that stuff. So it got me to thinking also that how Hadley is so unique in the amount of infrastructure it has for the population. There's a lot of infrastructure here for somewhere around 5,200 people in the population. So I look at that and the staffing and how it compares to other DPWs. We got a lot going on out there for a department of 19. There's a lot of moving parts every day. So I looked at the field superintendent position as an operational person to oversee operations from day to day in all divisions, to include the working foreman. So that would also give them time to oversee other projects, go from job to job, do inspections, which we're drawing a lot of our help off what their maintenance routines are and what their jobs are to do for inspections with different projects going on. With that being said, the water and sewer licenses, there's certain things that fall under their license that they're required to do the inspection. So I summed all that up, I put it all together, and I came up with what I call the field superintendent, which would be a lead foreman. Again, I don't want to key in on the field superintendent name, but so I put the job description together, and it's going to be a coverall for all three divisions operationally on a daily basis, or potentially up to five divisions if you include building maintenance, cemeteries, so on and so forth. So I presented the job description that you have before you, running with all that information.
Okay. Any questions for our director?
I guess what you just said, this would be the immediate follow-up to you. It would be the second in charge. For some reason, if you weren't able to be sickness or something, this person would fill that element?
Yes, and one of the more important pieces that I don't think I mentioned was when I was looking at the SWOT analysis and everything that's going on, I think successive planning of the DPW is a very important piece of that hasn't, I don't think, been addressed in the past, but going forward, I would like to address that. It may sound funny, I've been here 7 months, but I would be looking at this position to possibly step up to my position someday in a successive planning format.
And so I've read the job description, and it's a lot more responsibility than Mr. Keeler has as a working foreman.
Yes.
And that would be the difference.
Yes.
It's a step up from him and a step down from you.
Correct.
Basically.
Yes.
Okay.
Anyone else?
The line in there that starts with errors in judgment, what's that in there for?
Oh, and under environment. 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth paragraph down under environment.
It's in both.
Yeah, I'm just reading. I'm assuming that's
the paragraph. Yeah, exactly. Yes.
Mom.
This is information that you frequently find in job descriptions where there's a high degree of skill and judgment required. So I've seen this language before.
What does it mean?
It means that the person that you need has got to be pretty competent.
Yeah. Highly responsible, focused.
Because if you look at the heading, it's under, like, this one's under, I'm reading it under environment, so it's making it clear this sort of stress responsibility in the working environment that the individual would have to function within.
Yeah. So do people actually have this job, or is this open for applications?
Excuse me?
Is this job posted within the department, or is it going to be posted as an out job?
It would be, well, it's a non-union position to be posted, but absolutely in-house candidates could apply.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So we have a posting policy that will follow.
Yes.
So.
Okay. I was just wondering how that was all going to be.
So are we looking for, you're looking for approval from us this evening to move forward with this posting?
So moved.
Okay, is there a second on that?
I'll second that.
Wait a minute.
There's a second for discussion.
Second for discussion, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
Back 8 years ago or so, when the DPW was formed, the DPW director in the whole state approved application was for an engineer, and I had brought this up four or five years ago anyway, mm-hmm. when I first became on the board, you know, and they're putting a bachelor's degree in here along with a high school diploma, 7 to 10 years experience. This is all the stuff that we asked for the DPW director in the first place, mm-hmm. to hopefully replace when Michael retired, which he has now, mm-hmm. and take over some of these engineering projects. That's the way you sold it to the town meeting originally. The board sold it to the town meeting originally when I was sitting there, when I wasn't even on the board yet, and that's the way I understood it. You know, creating more high-paid positions really isn't getting the work done down there. We're still paying engineers, as he said. You know, and we just, I don't know what direction you guys are going in here.
Is there a question in there, or what are you saying? You think this is too...
What's it going to cost us? Yeah. What's it going to cost us? This originally was supposed to be the DPW director's position in the original legislation.
The fields. So the original org chart for the DPW contained this position, didn't it? The second in command?
Yeah, so what we did was back in 2008, 2009, when we put together the DPW in the first place, we had a number of organizational charts that showed the current position where we were without a DPW, what a DPW initially would look like, and then what in the future that DPW organization might look like. So each of those organizational charts, and we still have copies of these, look very different from each other because of the way that personnel skills and workforce were deployed. Mm-hmm. Over the years, we've had a number of revisions to those proposed reorganizational charts, and each one takes into account changing conditions and new opportunities and new demands upon the town. So this is just another reiteration of something we've been talking about since 2008.
I might want to add, it doesn't say there has to be a degree either. If you read it,
yeah,
it says or equivalent experience, basically, to sum it up. Right. I mean, it's not requiring a degree.
And Marlo, is this increasing your budget?
No. It's I'm looking at a range of between $58,000 and $65,000 for this position, which would be...
And how does that compare to the individual departing? That's significantly less, correct?
Yes, $10,000 to $18,000 a year.
Do you feel that you need an engineer on board in this town?
No.
Because everything's sent out basically to tie and bond and outfits like that to do the big plans.
I want to say that when I use the word unique about Hadley, I came from Greenfield. We had a four-person engineering department, a surveyor, an engineer, and an assistant engineer. It's a much larger community, a lot more infrastructure. I think with a community of 5,200 people, the community would not be able to afford an engineering department. And even if you had an engineer as the director, there's so many other things that go along with operations, and that's exactly what I'm saying here with this lead foreman. Outside of the office, outside of engineering, outside of being a director and what a director is tasked to do by the board and the town administrator and to keep up with everything that goes along with DPW, this is how I arrived at this. The community would not be able to afford an engineering division.
What would a going engineer pay the cost today? $125,000 a year? Maybe.
They specialize too, yeah. So it's they might be great for designing roads, but be completely useless. And that's not the right way to say that. But their forte, forgive me. They may be great at designing roads, but
really,
forgive me, engineers. They may be great at designing sewage systems, but not qualified to design a road for you. So, any community, and we learned this from the search committee when we were looking for prior to Marlo's job, because we had an engineer, we had the road superintendent from Long Meadow was on the committee and said, "You're doing this all wrong. to John's point. You're doing this all wrong. You're bringing an engineer in here, and the God's honest truth is that the engineer is not going to provide what you think he will. It's not that he's going to be able to stamp all these plans that you are sending out to get done now. That's not the way it works. He's going to be able to, you know, probably, you know, be able to help, you know, mitigate through that system, but they're only going to be able to sign certain things to get it done. If you don't have an engineering department with different fields being addressed, one engineer doesn't take care of it. It's not a catch-all account.
I got 2 points to that, Jerry. One point is, if you have an engineer on staff, whether it's your director, whoever it may be, they're not going to stamp their own plans in-house. It's a liability.
Right.
So you can pay an engineer, you know, and again, I deal with engineers every day. I have nothing against engineers. Please don't be, you know, don't take that wrong. But they're still gonna, it's still gonna cost money to send whatever they design out to put someone else's stamp on it. So my point was going the other way with this whole thing. My point was, if we have this person on staff between myself and that person, we can save the engineering inspection fees on a lot of these projects. And I use Route 9 as an example. That's all I was trying to say to that.
You know, when I look at this, it's the same scenario we're having in the police department and fire department. We're putting so much pressure on our two chiefs, they can't handle it. They need help, and you need help also in the DPW. It's quite obvious. And you have to have somebody there that's going to be there full-time, that can take over if you're out because of illness or vacation, and a backup person.
Okay, so we have a motion made and seconded to, Yeah, we do.
Yeah.
It's been so long.
For discussion.
Like I said, I just made the point. That's the way the DPW was
originated
and sold to the taxpayers
to
create the DPW in the first place. That's all I'm saying.
And it was going to save the town a lot of money.
Okay,
limiting
audience participation at this point because of the lateness. So we have a motion made and seconded. Ready to put
Can
it to a vote?
Can we read the motion again? I've lost what it
is. The motion is to accept the job descriptions as presented.
Now, are we voting just the one or both together?
The 12 of them.
Both.
Together. Okay, I just wanted to back the clarification.
If you're going to do both of them, we need the second one to be discussed as well.
Yeah, we didn't discuss the second one yet. Okay.
So,
The second one, the second job description that I presented to the board is basically a combination of two job descriptions that's been being performed by one person in the department for many years. I combine both job descriptions together, and also going along with, again, the SWOT analysis and my goals and objectives I presented, we have a lot going on down in the department. Sharon Gifford has actually built the work order system we have in place. We're up to about close to 700 work orders, by the way, 450 complete. We're also moving into the area where mapping and GIS and all that needs to be maintained. Once we go into that area and we get all our maps into the GIS system, she now performs all the IT support. She provided IT support in the town hall also and in our department. She handles all the DEP paperwork day in and day out. She's real familiar with DEP. This position is actually putting both job descriptions together becomes a position of promotion for her. She will be overseeing the operational duties of the water division on a day-to-day basis from an operational standpoint. And what I mean by this is bringing all the work orders, the workload. She schedules all the appointments for the water department. How does that play into the actual field work with the other two divisions, with one backhoe, if we're going to be doing an excavation, so on and so forth. So this job description just basically brings both in job descriptions together. She also maintains the MS4, which technically falls under highway, but she's been maintaining the MS4 permit. As we all know, we have a big update to the MS4 coming up. She's been going to a few of the meetings with me. She's ready to take that on. That's an expensive, unfunded mandate, but we've also discussed where I think we can take on some of that cost in-house as far as some of the requirements under the MS4. So,
is this basically the same job description that Mike Pequita has for the sewer department?
No.
It's more advanced than his?
Yes.
But she's just going to be solely dealing with the water, not the sewer?
Well, I put in the job description, I worded it actually that she will provide backup for some of the sewer paperwork because we have coverage with Mr. Pequinot's position from 8 to 1. We have people that come in after 1 needing assistance. So that had to be put into the job description for that purpose.
Okay.
I got one more statement made here, boss. On the first part there, for your special requirements for your foreman or supervisor or field supervisor or whatever.
Which one? The first one
he's back to.
Going back?
First one, page 4.
Yep.
Your special requirements. Grade D2 is for distribution. Grade T2 is for water treatment.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yes.
And do you know what the wastewater treatment plant grade is? Because that says wastewater. It should be 4M.
Okay, that is a typo. But I also started the requirements. When you look at a position like this, nobody has every license required. It's required to every operator in every division to come through the door.
But if you want to replace some of the people that are thinking about retiring out pretty soon, you know,
I'm not that far down the road, but this isn't a position for the wastewater treatment plant.
I know.
That's to show that they have collections experience out in the field or they have knowledge of the wastewater treatment plant to supervise.
Well, this says T2 wastewater treatment, so that's just a starting point is what you're going to do with that then?
Yes.
Okay, so do we want to reiterate or offer a new motion that covers both job descriptions?
That was my original anyway.
All right.
Okay. What's the change in Sharon's job from what we're projecting here to what she currently does? Let's not talk about her specifically.
Right.
The job that you have listed here, what's the difference between how it's being accomplished now and how you foresee it being accomplished? What specifically is different?
What's specifically different is she's actually going to be maintaining the work order system. She's going to be maintaining the priorities of the work order system within the water division and how it plays out in the plant work they have to do every day, plus the excavations we have scheduled. She's also taken on the work order system. There's a certain amount of time and maintenance on that daily to generate them, to start generating these databases, which we are starting to generate. She's also into the new fuel system, by the way, that got installed today. There's a lot of IT stuff, the new fuel system software.
But that's getting done now, right? I mean, who's doing that now? Why is that new?
She has been doing most of that.
Okay, so that's not being added. That's just a common function that's being done today.
There's a lot of things that this position has been performing for a long time that's not even in either job description, let alone combining the two. There's a lot of work going in and on in all the divisions, including dealing with the recycling in Amherst recently, that this position has been taking care of for years. So there's a lot that's being done in this position.
And again,
I would think the biggest responsibilities now is the MS4 drainage,
yes,
which we haven't had to deal with up until a couple months ago, and we're really into it now. And that's going to be a big part of her job description,
right,
and handle all that paperwork.
And I think, yeah, that's very important to say that both these positions were within the budget. We're under my existing budget for this to happen that I'm in. So there's no increase in budget here.
Motion second from the floor, Chair.
Okay. So motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Abstain.
Okay. All right. Thank you. You good?
Thank you.
Okay, next we have Friends of Zaterka Park.
Go home.
Hurry.
Hurry, go home. Run.
So you got a different context here. Former school committee, former HCAT advisory. Wow.
Looks so good.
That's right.
All dressed.
Right. Oh, yeah. Okay.
venue.
So Kathy, you're here to do a, an update tonight for the Friends of Satirica Park, and I see you have Mr. Wells from Berkshire Design Group.
Yeah, I'm going to do the introductions, but there it is. This is Mr. Wells from Berkshire Design. A few core members are here from the Friends of Satirica Park and our commission, of course. Peter and the core has worked really, really hard at our exciting new now plan for Satirica Park. And we're here to present that to you. David David Alvine, Sean Mackin are here as well. And Peter will discuss it with you at this point with the diagrams and so forth. Again, thank you to the core group of friends and the other friends of Satirica Park that aren't here tonight. We couldn't have done this without you, and of course, Berkshire Design. Thank you.
Thanks, Kathy. Once again, my name is Peter Wells with the Berkshire Design Group. We're landscape architects, civil engineers, and surveyors from Northampton. We've been working with the committee for about 6 months now to develop a master plan and go through the master plan process. We're at that point now where we have a final master plan. And prior to that, we've done site inventory and analysis to look at the potentials and the constraints the site had to offer. It's a 6-acre existing park site, as many of you know. The major constraint the site has is basically its slopes. And those can also be a potential, meaning that we can take advantage of the steep slopes that are in the park and use them to our advantage with regard to program elements. There's about a 56-foot grade change from the front of the existing lawn area on Huntington Ave on to the back area. So we have to deal with that as far as adding park elements that we came up with. We've met 6 or 7 times now with master plan ideas. We started by coming up with conceptual ideas for the plan. We developed 5 different options as far as where components can be located. We discussed at length what program elements might be needed for a park of this size with regard to what do the people want in a park for Hadley. So I'm going to present the final plan, and when I say final master plan, it's not a plan that's cast in stone yet. We can still make changes because it is a master plan. We have rearranged the parking area to create roughly the same size as what exists there now, but a safer parking area that comes off of Huntington Road further down so that the site distances are more adequate. Right now you enter right at the corner and you park along here, and also you park along Huntington Road and you back out into the road, which is an unsafe condition. So we've created a small parking area for 18 cars, located access right off of Huntington, added street trees throughout. We have a half-court basketball located here, and during larger events that may occur within the park, you can park right on the basketball court because it will be striped. So that's an additional 9 spaces or so. We have a wide walkway that comes back here that will both double as a walkway system, but also for vehicles that may want to park back here, or service vehicles that may want to come into the park along with emergency vehicles. There'll be bollards here that are removable or a gate, so one can access the back portion through there. As you meander back here, we have a small storage shed that can house equipment for maintenance and or equipment for some of the active sports that we have included. The central area is an area that will be roughly 3 or 4 feet above the lawn area because we have to make grade changes throughout. It will have a main playground area, which will have an area for ages 2 to 5 tots, and also ages 5 to 12 and on up. And it will be separated by a walkway that comes between them. We haven't chosen all the playground equipment yet. That comes at a later phase when we really start talking numbers and surface materials, etc. We also have 2 horseshoe pits located close by to the picnic area, which is located here. We have a pavilion that's centrally located and can be used for both picnicking but also any entertaining or events that may occur there. It's also a shade structure. As you meander back here, as I mentioned, we have parking here for people with disabilities or people that wanted to get closer to the amphitheater. This is a natural amphitheater that will slope up. We have a structure located here that can be either a band shell, a temporary band shell, or a permanent one. So it's a place, it's placed here because we want to take advantage of the slope and create a natural grass area for people to sit and watch a watch the entertainment. This whole area here is fully accessible, but as you move back into the park, the grades are such that we can't have it fully accessible. So we have our amphitheater, and then we decided to do some clearing of trees that exist there now and create an overlook. So this overlook will have a viewshed of the entire Holyoke Range, which it doesn't have now because of the vegetation that's located there. So that's a nice amenity, and I think will be attractive. Our walkway system, our trail system begins at the parking area as it does now, meanders along the property line, meanders out to our overlook area, and then takes advantage of the back area, wooded area that we have remained very natural. We will go in there and tag trees that are worth saving and trees that are invasive species. We have areas for sitting, for view sheds. We have a whole list of what can occur back here. We're not sure exactly what may occur, but this is what can occur. Everything from small group camping to treehouse village to interpretive signage to nature journaling, animal tracking, Pokemon Go, which is a big thing now with various areas, even parks. If you contact the company and you want your park to be on Pokemon Go, you can, and people will be visiting the park and getting out from inside to outside. I visited a park today in Fitchburg, and I went up to this large pond area, and there were 45 people with their phones out, just walking around this pond, and they were doing Pokemon. So I interviewed them and asked them how many of them had never been there, and there were quite a few that had not. So it was interesting. This is also a park for all ages, from young to old. We have exercise stations located throughout the lower loop area. And those exercise stations are for seniors and juniors. So horseshoes also. So that's the master plan in a nutshell. We've taken advantage of as much use of the level areas as possible. It's a 6-acre park. It still will remain rather rural because of this back area here, but it will remain somewhat open out front. We have a lawn area here that can be used for frisbee, for small-sided games, and we have a practice wall here that people can use if they wanted to get a little practicing with soccer. But it's not meant to be an active soccer field whatsoever. There'll be signage there. We're going to reuse the Zaterka Park stone, the memorial stone that's out there. There'll be signage out front also. There'll be small fencing out front, lower than what's out there now, probably 4 to 5 foot high. And that is to keep in any activities that might be occurring here. So,
what's the size of the lawn field that's depicted there?
I would say this is 120 across by maybe 150.
And would it be the intent that the park would be posted, all out before dark, or
Yeah, there isn't any electricity at this point, yeah, it would be after dusk type of.
Yeah.
We're going to bring in, conduits from Huntington on back to where entertainment may occur, but we don't plan on any lights whatsoever. It'll be.
And maintaining the opened areas, I can see where the back part would be maintained as maybe a conservation area of sorts where people will walk. There's many in Maine or wherever that those areas are.
Exactly.
Maintained as just trails where people can walk. My concern is of the area, is it going to, who's going to be maintaining the cut areas and upkeep of the park itself? How is that going to play into the town? So do you have any questions? Is it going to be, where are we going to have DPW
to come in, and it'd probably be easier at this point than it is now.
And have you all spoken with our DPW director on this project?
We have. I've talked to Marlo about it. Marlo, you're right here. So we're, you know, this is a master plan that's just come to be. So he hasn't been to our most recent meetings, but he did walk the grounds. Yeah. We walked the grounds together, and we talked about the equipment that's out there currently and the amount of time currently it's taking versus what it will and should take.
And of course, for safety, police and fire, you've mm-hmm. spoken to.
We did. We spoke. I
chiefs.
Spoke to both chiefs, mm-hmm. and that's one of the points they made, is to make sure that they were able to get up and around, and so that's the barrier area that they'll mm-hmm. be able to drive right up and get into the areas in the back. They had brought that up and.
I'm just asking these questions for
transparency
public-wise here. I think people are curious at home just about that.
Sure, for sure.
We met the past 6 months, Sundays and Thursdays and holidays and everything. Mm-hmm. A lot of planning has gone to this. I think the big concept was to try to look at every age and represent the youth mm-hmm. to the elderly. So I spent 16 years abroad in Sweden, beautiful, wonderful parks. What we wanted to bring really to this is, like, with our strengths training stations, hopefully that, you know, we work to get that, is we get elderly into the park. Mm-hmm. We get ADA accessible pathways to get every single person to get them in there, and to be able to have a possibility of amphitheater to and a pavilion for park and rec programs or possible summer programs to try to represent the best of Hadley and give every age a venue to be able to enjoy. Mm-hmm. And that was our goal, and we really worked hard at that. Mm-hmm. I think we have a lot of work to do, but we have a marketing plan right now. We have people helping us, if we can just pass these out, brochures of what we're trying to do. So we're trying to get together our marketing plan right now. And Dave, I'm not sure if you want to speak a little bit to that.
Yeah, Sean and I and Yvonne Kilt, we've been acting as volunteers, working with the commissioners on various activities related to it. One is we're very aware that in addition to town support, we're going to need to continue to rely on volunteer support, mm-hmm. both for the maintenance and the general upkeep. And we already had a successful park cleanup day earlier this year. We're looking forward to another one probably in early September. But there's going to need to be ongoing support from individuals and from local businesses. We've already had significant interest from Lowe's, has spoken with Kathy multiple times. So we're aware that support will come from there. We've also got Jen Lapis, who's been helping us mm-hmm. identify grant opportunities. So we know that that's another revenue source. Mm-hmm. And we probably will go back to CPA at some point as well. So we see a variety of ways to not put the total burden on Marlo and the DPW, but to spread it out. There's a lot of volunteer energy that we think we can harness.
And what I gave you now is only a rough draft, so that is not a formal document that will go out. I think what we're looking at right now is dividing the project into three phases. So the first phase we're looking to get into later this fall. So as David said, we're looking to have our next cleanup probably in early November. where we're going to try to get all of our friends together and really start to make a push. There, in phase one, is where we can start to do a lot of the clearing and grading. Peter, I'm not sure if you want to speak to just phase one and then how we would progress through there.
Sure. Phase one, we're hoping to do in November, and we wanted to basically make the site look more inviting. We wanted to do the site demolition work, which is taking out the asphalt tennis courts, the asphalt parking area that is in rough shape, taking out the backstops, the fencing that we don't need anymore, the debris piles that are piled out back here, and clearing some of the vegetation that's out there so that you start to envision what this park can actually be by opening it up, clearing areas along here and here and some areas in the back. And if all goes well, if we do go out to bid, we might want to try and do some rough grading at this point in hopes of going back out for phase two in the springtime. But we're not sure how far we're going to get because time is short, but we feel we can get some of the site demo done.
John, you had a question?
Yeah. What are you guys doing for drainage?
Drainage, we're going to go subsurface infiltration basins throughout in areas that where the soils can comply with that. We don't have any drainage along Huntington, so we can't tie into any subsurface drainage whatsoever, so it's going to all have to be done on site.
But in fact, the drainage from Breckenridge runs right around and right into there. What are you going to do with that? That road, that drainage, right? It doesn't come across the road. It runs right around into there. What are you going to do with that?
I don't know. I haven't looked at anything but a quick walk on this.
We'll have to speak to Marlo in more detail with regard to that. We were containing the water that we generated on site. I didn't realize that there was water from Breckenridge.
It's all downhill. Where do you think it goes?
Well, typically it would come down here and follow.
I walk that road every day. So if I come down with my dog and then I walk up Breckenridge, if it's raining or everything is coming down street, right on that street, there are two drains existing in that park there. Those two are existing, and so it is pretty dry in there. But all of that drainage would come down Breckenridge Road. There's not a lot going into it.
Well, you're going to have to come in front of the planning board anyway.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right.
We're going to go for a site plan review.
One of our main concerns on the planning board, I'll tell you right now.
Sure.
So, Kathy, you're, again, just the relationship between, this is the Friends of Zaterka Park, but I'm just noticing here it says that donations can be made to the Friends of Hadley Park and Rec.
Mm-hmm.
So this is in cooperation with the Park and Rec?
Department, for sure. Commissioner, this is the Park and Rec.
Well, and also the Friends of Park and Rec.
Right.
Which is the other, the 503C, a donation arm that is not directly part under the control of the commission.
Right, but it can accept support funds.
Yes.
Right. Yeah, okay.
And Molly?
Yep.
We're just at a meeting with USDA, and mm-hmm. they have some grants available for redevelopment and business and other things like that. Maybe you can approach them and see what they've got. If you're available for funding, it's through them, you know. They have a bunch of other programs out there.
You know, I commend the commission and the Friends to have the vision to bring something like this to the town of Hadley. It's been needed a long time. But the only question that brings to mind is, at this point, there is no federal or state money involved in this. If you go out and seek federal and state funds, that means this park has to be open to everybody. So that's a decision that has to be made. Is it only going to be for residents of the town of Hadley? If we don't take any federal and state money, you can accomplish that. But once you take a grant with federal or state money, everybody can use that park. So that's mm-hmm. something you have to bear in mind, I think.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. We have a budget right now that uses CPA and the George Edward Fund. How much of phase one, two, and three is it going to be accomplished by the use of that money now?
We think phase one, less than half of it to get through all of phase one.
we can look through probably half of phase two. What our goal right now is to make this park look inviting. Like, the plan right now is, let's have a fall cleanup in November. There we would show everybody, put signage on and say this is the future site of the new park, and this is the design, and this is what we're going with. And to, over the winter, to build our marketing plan and to reach out so that once we hit that spring, then we're going to start work actively through the winter and to raise funds for this. We understand that anything like this, it has to come from the people of Hadley. It has to, and people have to get involved. To me, it shouldn't just be three people and hitting big corporations and it's done. That's not realistic. We understand how much work is involved. We understand how hard we have to work to get everybody else involved. I think for this park to be really successful, it's going to be at its best if we can get 120 people there and everybody working and everybody understanding that we can do great things here. So we're very realistic that over a 2 to 3 year period, it would take that long to get us to a playground completion. So we don't think this is going to be magic. We understand that's a lot of hard work, but we also we respect the process, and we think that for us to get the result that we want, everybody has to be aware of what we're doing, mm-hmm. and that's why we're here. We're really trying to be transparent and let everybody know and kind of build just a strong message of let's everybody help, and that's why we're taking a little bit longer with our marketing plan and trying to do all the stuff behind the scenes so that we're all prepared to go once we're all set.
No, it's a great community project. There's no question. Right. The woodchuck funds, are those possibly available for this, or is that strictly under the purview of Park and Rec? You know.
So the woodchuck fund, there are three components of it. Park and Rec controls.
Was it 25,000?
I think it's 10,000.
That was
25. Is it 25? Okay, yeah. It's the 25. I can never remember. Planning board gets 10, conservation got 375, and parking rec got 25.
Right.
Of that 25 for you, I think all of it still remains.
Right, we haven't tapped anything since the Lowe's. That was from the Lowe's deal.
Right. There were planning board is, there's about 200 left in conservation.
But the best, I mean, the funds haven't been touched since then. Okay. Mm-hmm.
That requires a joint select board and Park and Rec vote to access that money.
So that's consideration. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
What's down below?
Yeah. Existing condition photos, that's all. What's out there now?
But that on the left is the trails. So that's this the is that we'd like to continue. Mm-hmm. In
existing
the
trail system that could use some gravel just for stability. Existing tennis courts that will come down. This is the start of our amphitheater. Existing pavement that's there now. So it's a park that has seen.
Is that old sand pit in the back?
Mm-hmm.
Is there still piles of stone and lumber?
There's one large pile.
That was highway or that was DPW storage at one time.
We're going to use some of that stone depending on its makeup for the trail system.
And you've also talked about the trails that are up there, and I encourage people they're already up there, and you could take a walk in it. Extensive yet, but they are in place for locals that have created them. A little self-generation up there, but I think part of the plan was to interconnect with some other trails in the area that maybe reach out as far as Mount Warner. That has to do somewhat with the butters, but you guys have a few. There are plans for trying to connect that to other trail systems in the area.
Where the current ball field is presently, is there still any sinking from the stump dump being there, or how would you deal with that? Does it have to be compacted with large machinery or something so there's no more sinking?
There are some small sinkholes there that are roughly 12 inches deep. I counted last time I was there, three. This area is going to be regraded and recompacted. We're not saying that there'll never be sinkholes there, because to excavate the entire stump dump would be not cost-effective. So that's why we labeled this as a passive lawn area. You can still run around on it, but sinkholes will have to be addressed in the future on a one-by-one basis.
Okay. So my understanding tonight is this was for information. So again, in the spirit of keeping everybody apprised and promoting public awareness of the project. So I think you've accomplished it nicely. Thank you.
Thank you.
We have a few other agenda items we still need to get through here. So
thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for all your work.
Look forward to seeing again. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Looks great.
Thank you very much for your work.
So next
time. And checks are available to be sent to?
Donations can be made to Friends of Hadley Park and Rec. You'd probably want to make it clear that it is for the Zaterko Park project.
There is a Facebook page as well.
And there's a Facebook page as well. Okay, so next we have the Park and Rec Commission requested audience this evening. So I think we're here to talk about the relocation of the Park and Rec Department. So David, you want to cue that up?
Yeah, so the town took out an RFP to sell North Hadley Village Hall. We received a bid back. That bid was accepted. Back in July, I contacted Kathy Zaterka and Suzanne Travisano in order to talk about the possibility of a relocation of the administrative offices of the Park and Rec Commission from the North Hadley Village Hall, since it was presumably going to be sold, and to see if there's space available in the current senior center. The two department heads worked together to talk about their space needs and what were the available spaces at the senior center, and came up with a plan for administrative offices to be supported in that building. They reported back to me that this is working out. We since got in touch with the Department of Public Works back in August to talk about the facilitating the move, we have committed to a process of an orderly and sane progression from one building to the other, and to keep the lines of communication open. So that's where we are. I believe that the move is scheduled for a little bit later on in this month.
Well, part of the concern, of course, is maintaining programming throughout the relocation. And what has been established in the budget so far is some rent and utility money for maintaining programming space, as we'll be going to just administrative offices. And we noticed that it's still in the budget, and we're kind of waiting before we commit to any engagements with rent for the fall town meeting, so that budget can pass and then the funds can be allocated. Is that a correct position?
So rent, the administrative piece of it's taken care of, but you're talking about renting program space?
Yeah.
For like Zumba?
Right. Or, whatever programs that, we used to run a lot more up at North Hadley Hall before, code restrictions and issues with the building caused contraction of the, sure, of the offerings.
But most of them are at had the elementary school, the fields, right, all the outdoor stuff. There's one up in Deerfield. And then, so North Hadley Hall, this is summer, just looking at the list of programming. I understood that Zumba was the kind of the immediate concern, right? Because that's probably the most, isn't that like one of the most well-attended programs?
That one is, and it's the most, it's daily, it's 6 days a week, or 5 days a week, sorry.
Right.
At the North Hadley Hall, and basically the other 5 day a week, every week, would be during the summer at the North Hadley Hall for the children's programming.
Okay.
But we have some time for that. Program and participation.
The only other one I see is Fun with Kathy and Friends. Is that?
That's during the vacation weeks. That's also a Park and Rec week during February and April vacation.
So any possibility, okay, if it's school vacation week, to use the school?
I'm not 100% sure about that, but I do have another school in mind to use it. The schools have used it for basketball during the day, their games during the day in the gymnasiums, yeah, and so forth during the February vacations.
the April one, I haven't gone as far out to know, but...
Could you theoretically clear out, like, clear out, meaning like if there were desks in a room, like...
I'm not 100%, yeah. So the school, there is one room at the elementary school I can speak to that's...
Big enough.
Big enough for our after-school programs that we have there currently. We have 5-day-a-week programs there now. Well, they're not currently, but they're offered. We're waiting to fill them. Mm-hmm. But they're there for 5-day-a-week, and I think it's room 112. Not 100% sure, but that's at the elementary school. And yes, it can be cleared out and used. We're actually thinking about putting a dance program in there for after-school because the gymnasium and the cafeteria are used. Mm-hmm. So there is that one room. They don't like us generally to use the classrooms. They're the teachers' spaces, and oftentimes teachers are in
stuff.
There.
Yeah. Kind of
thing. There is one extra room at the elementary school that we're able to use at 3 o'clock, just right at the end of school, and until whenever we need it. And we have been using that regularly, at least 2 and 3 times a week for after school. This year, I scheduled 5-day-a-week ones. We'll see if we get registration for that, but... So to your point, I'm not sure if the high school has that similar scenario. I'm thinking they might, but I know
like
the
resource room, maybe at Hopkins or something like that.
Mm-hmm. And the other thing about, so for, I guess what we're talking about is the February-April vacation. So it may be a possibility to use that.
Mm-hmm. In Zumba, have you approached like the Legion or?
The Legion has a wonderful fencing program that, uses their facility. Actually, it was a park and rec program, and we still sponsor them. But they do use that as a location, and they actually pay the Legion rent. And it's a pretty hefty fee, so we can't compete with them. I'm glad they're successful. Mm-hmm. We brought them to them, so that's good. We started the program over at North Hadley Hall.
Could Zumba be maybe something at the mall? Like they certainly have space at the mall.
I did look at the mall, mm-hmm. and I went through 2 different rooms at the mall. One of the rooms would require rubber mat flooring. Mm-hmm. The other one, which is more expensive, might be all right, but the one they really offered us was $1,000 a month. Mm-hmm.
What about the large area on the Council on Aging for Zumba? Mm-hmm. If you could work out dates with them downstairs. Yes.
That is also, we did look at that. There's also a concrete floor, and it's half rug and half concrete floor, so it's not great with those Zumba moves. In fact, it's a little difficult to be maybe on this style flooring, and then all of a sudden switch to rug, you could fall easily. If we switch the flooring, that might be a possibility. But working like Zumba in a dance style movement is not good on a concrete floor. For anyone, especially the consistent trainers that are there each day. So we did look at that, and Suzanne certainly showed us that area. I have looked. I appreciate all the suggestions. I have looked at all of them. Years ago we did talk about the Regish building across from the elementary school. Mm-hmm. That certainly would have worked because that had a gymnasium within it.
Yeah.
And the floor of that would have been perfect as well. But we missed that opportunity. And there are some other opportunities we missed because we keep sort of waiting mm-hmm. for the day that says, you know, I don't have to write, you know, more than I. So here we are, I guess. But I am looking, and the Zumba people have called a Zumba-a-thon, 75 minutes, woo-hoo, on the 13th of October, last day, woo-hoo, come. And fun party. But that'll be a free class, by the way.
Yeah. So that's $1,500 of revenue, right? That one program.
Yeah,
it's when I'm
right.
At.
You know, so again, it's we're service oriented. You know, if we some during the summer, we may not even get $100 a month on
that
program. So, but again, we're service oriented group. It's a sad day when we have to say goodbye to Zumba. It's been with us for about 10 years. Mm-hmm. But I, you know, we've been looking.
Holy Redeemer Parish Hall.
Again, the floor.
Yep, the floor. Yep.
The McKeshen building, anything in there?
It's concrete.
Any room, but I'm sure it's expensive.
Okay. Well, I was just thinking of the PT area over there. I wonder if we could collaborate with them for a little while. to have a PT area. I'm sure it's not concrete floor.
Oh, that's right. Yeah,
Chloe Dick has a PT plant. They already said that was taken.
Yeah.
Do you look at this space downstairs in the congregational church? The congregational?
No.
The cafe or the dining area down there? I don't know if it would be big enough.
It's a water issue again.
It's downstairs.
It's a wooden floor.
Like concrete?
But they also have programming at night. They have some community groups that meet there. Just the same as me. I have four or five groups that meet during the evening. Yeah, it's a 5:30 to 6:30, or we could be flexible, 6 to 7.
What about the third floor at the Hooker School?
Hooker School?
Egress.
Yes, we've talked about that. It would be awesome, but there's an egress issue. I wish we could just throw a ladder out that north window. It's the north side that the elevator's in the way of the staircase.
There's not a second.
Because I would like that space as well upstairs.
A blow-up slide.
I don't mind.
Park and Rec.
But yes, I did think of that. It was an egress issue.
So was the question, can you keep the Zumba program in North Hadley Hall, or you're looking to spend money to rent space that you haven't found yet, or what's the question?
Yeah, I think that part of it is that I think we've applied for that money in the budget. The last we knew it was still in the budget, right?
What money, Andy? I'm not sure what you're...
The commission had submitted for potential $24,000 in rent and $12,000 in utilities. Part of that money had been...
That was in the expanded budget.
Right, the expanded, but not the approved
program expansion.
Spring town meeting budget. Okay, yep.
So we're hoping that as our time runs out here that those monies will still be appropriated and that we can continue our search for programming space and look to not only maintain, but to, again, revitalize programs that, like I was saying before, that we used to provide, but due to building conditions, we were no longer able to offer. Mm-hmm. So we want to revive some of this rather than just continue to contract.
Right.
Does Whole Children have a large facility? Have you ever checked there for their children?
Actually, that's how
children?
I knew about the what's Greg. Now the mattress shop. Because I worked with Whole Children for a few years. Mm-hmm. And they do have a space, but they have a beautiful space, but it's a little limiting, and they have tons of programming as well. Some of these places that are willing to help us are great, but they're like, yes, you can come Wednesday the 14th, and then, you know, Monday the 30th, you know. Not an every day at a specific time.
Mm-hmm.
Another great idea, and I'm sure Whole Children would be happy to help. But
well, and I certainly understand that, you know, obviously just the Council on Aging and the library and everybody. I mean, people want to expand the offerings, which should certainly, and I hope that's everybody's goal here as well, to the extent the taxpayers want to support it. But I also just wanted to make sure that right now what we're talking about is one program, potentially the vacation programs, but one program, Zumba, that's bringing in $1,500.
That we don't have a home for.
That we don't have a home for.
Right.
Well, then there's the opportunity cost.
Plus the vacation and vacation programs.
Although, you know, it seems like that one, I hope we could find a home for from... Because the space requirements aren't quite as stringent as the Zumba, which you need a certain flooring for. And I'm just talking about this fiscal year, not long-term solution, but just this fiscal year. That's what we're looking at. Right? I mean...
Well, we don't know. You know, certainly short-term, you're looking at this fiscal year. Don't know how long this arrangement's going to be in place right now. Foreseeable future. So... If we want to maintain a vibrant park and rec department, we want to make sure that we have programming space available.
Right.
Not every program is going to be revenue positive.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes when you bring in some of these programs, they are service. Again, like lunch mm-hmm. with Santa Claus.
Sure. Yeah, definitely.
The gym at the cafeteria at the high school?
I can't think of that.
I think Kathy's been doing a good job working with the schools, finding what space is available.
I'm just thinking that they're not always used, even when they have basketball games or everything else. You know, that's not a used room every day, and if you're only going to use it from 5:30 to 6:30, it certainly might.
Right, and then the occasional time where they have a program, we would then not have it. Again, it's the flooring, and if it were to be, here we'll have a Zumba class this week, fine, the flooring's okay, but consistently, we have people who come, you know, 4 days a week, and that's really tough, shin splints and stuff. But, yeah, so, I mean, we're continuing to look. We're not just like, see ya. We are continuing to look. They, because of the need and getting back to the North Hadley Hall and our move would be because of that need, because mm-hmm. of our budget, or lack thereof, without disrespect, we needed to come up with an end date just because our clients are waiting to know, and mm-hmm. more importantly, our great Zumba instructors are also waiting to know. So we had to come up with that date, and we found that the 13th was that because of the October deadline. So here we are.
Yeah, so I'm just looking at the warrant, the under park commission's other salaries, there's a modest COLA increase, but then under expenses, it's a plus $42,386 for expanded program.
Mm-hmm.
Right, that's the number you're talking about?
That would be for the $24,000 for building rental, $12,000 for utilities, and then an additional 5 hours for myself as the program coordinator. That would be going to 30 hours a week. And I thought that would be sort of needed given our situation. Working more with the school and trying to find programming and so forth. So those are the three items that make up that 42.
Okay.
Not to change the subject matter, but I don't know what burner you have a future home on now, you know, but I have the plan before me of the build out of the new athletic fields at Hopkins Academy, and directly behind the gymnasium going in a westerly direction, there's a plot of land there that is not designated for anything, and there's accessibility for West Street, and it would be an ideal location for you because you use all these athletic fields, you know. And I don't know if you've had any discussion with the school about the total build out there, or is there some availability of land in that build out?
There's been conversation about putting a park and rec, effectively a trailer that some other towns have, mm-hmm. in that type of facility, but I think it doesn't address the programming issue that they have now for the type of space for Zumba programming.
No, that's why I said I didn't mean to change the subject.
Yeah,
but I wanted to bring it to someone's attention that that area is there, and it's X'd out with a square, and there's nothing in it.
Yep.
Well, not only are the facilities there, Donald, all the people that from the schools that help out the mm-hmm. students.
Yeah,
then they don't have to have any transportation if they don't have licenses.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Plus, you wouldn't interfere because there's a separate entryway from
right.
West Street.
Right. That's no longer there. That was sold when the property was traded between
was
the town and the
Rex's.
Yeah. There's no more access. There used to be in between the Rex's and the Divine
yeah.
House.
Yeah.
There
yeah.
used to be a 75.
Yeah.
There used to be a 75 foot right of way.
You don't mind.
But and when they wanted to come out for West Street and take and eliminate bringing the kids in off of Route 9. But that's gone when the trade happened on the land of the Rex.
Still existing.
No.
When they
didn't need your garden.
Well, I'm welcome.
Yeah,
well, the small snowmobile trail.
They all the way to the end of your property and we'll land on to
it. Well, see, the old gym was also offered to us, but it was so shattered that we decided not to go along with it.
But that
maybe
still
we should,
that piece of property is that, available.
That's what I'm talking about.
We kind of had a little conversation with the library mm-hmm. about using that because it's still town property.
We're looking for a Zumba class, and now you guys are building a building. Let's find a home
you
for Zumba. It'll be a lot cheaper for the town.
You never know where you want to go. Strike a match anywhere.
So we're actively looking for a Zumba place, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Truly, it would be nice if we could find
right.
a Zumba place. We're talking about room 112 of the school, but that's not really, the floor is not really conducive.
That'll be for my other programming at this point.
Okay. Yeah, finding the spring board floor is going to be a challenge, but there's got to be something out there.
What is the qualifications, and nobody in this room is going to be able to answer this, but I know we're talking about second egresses, but what's the necessary qualification for a second egress to qualify?
Why can't we ask Tim that?
Well, we can, but I mean, you know, what's...
I wasn't kidding when I said a throw ladder, right?
Stay away from the throw ladder, but we could build...
Why not?
Can we pose that question to Tim Nyhart this week?
Yep.
If you could put a fire escape there.
The heater's in the way on that third floor to cut a window in, because I had to crawl out of it to check out the new part of the roof. But then you need a staircase off the new part of the roof down to the ground level.
Well, I mean, we're going to be taking a tour of the buildings on the 15th, so...
Yeah, so why don't we pose the question to Tim this week, and then David, could you get back to Kathy and the commission about the answer to that?
That third floor would solve a lot of your problems if we could make it accessible for it, or have a second egress, would it not?
One thought is, you know, the staircase kicks back on itself if you were to continue.
Everybody tells me what we can't do. Nobody wants to work towards what we can't.
Right, so David, I think it's Tim Nyhart.
That would be a cool place for the office, too.
And we still have to throw the entire warrant into other articles.
There was an office up there, the principal's office.
There is an office up there with the bathroom, the principal's office.
So was your intent tonight to raise awareness? Make sure that we understand what the issue is? You're not looking for us to act on anything tonight?
No, we just want to make sure that, you know, what we had planned on hopefully has not changed since we started.
The budget number is still there?
It's still in the expanded programming on the warrant that we haven't talked about yet.
To accommodate the third floor would be a very costly project. And the library is proposing to tear the building down, so it'd be another waste of money.
And how much stuff did they stuff up there? How many rooms are full from the library?
Well, there's all the maps and all the rest of that on the south side. On the north side, there's just a bunch of the long benches that were taken out of here that are being stored up there. Plus, you have all the old nurses' stuff, the electric wheelchairs and really scary stuff.
Is our planning room being moved for the planning board?
No, they're going across the hall.
So, Kathy, you're going to stay the course with doing what you're doing, right? Which is trying to find space.
Always finding space. Since the North Hadley Hall's been limited, and to begin with, we've tried to broker it out to other places.
So I'm assuming us trying to solve it for you is usually never achieves a very good end result when the select board chimes in on this stuff. So we'll let you keep doing what you're doing. We're well aware of the situation. So, I mean, thanks for highlighting it, because it is part of that warrant article that we have to be discussing.
Right, and of course, whether or not the sale's going through and all those types of things are planning, because we know that what's planned and what actually happens and where our storage material could, you know, when we have to
announce it.
Right. But again, the good news is the bulk of the programming doesn't happen to be at North Hadley Hall, so we can stay the course with the lion's share of the programming.
Now, one of the last things, Molly, are you giving us a date to move out of there?
I think it's like the later October is the move date, is that correct?
Right. For the office, right?
Yeah.
Zumba's the 13th, that's Thursday. And we'll be doing about the same.
Yeah.
If that's what you're...
Yeah.
We need the finalization.
Yeah, because it didn't seem to make any sense. I mean, even if you could have stayed in there until November or whatever, why bother? I mean, the space is available, so the thought was to get it over and done with, get Kathy settled.
Yeah, nobody wants to move in the snow.
Right, exactly, yeah. Okay?
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you guys.
Thanks.
Thank you. All right, we have the special town warrant, special town meeting warrant to review. And one thing that we need to add to this is we do need to re-vote the warrant posting.
Right.
Just for, I don't want to forget about that. I guess there was just a question about the clarity of that posting, which is essential to make sure that this is fully legal.
Does anybody need a paper copy of the warrant?
Thank you.
Yeah, I could do this.
Has it changed any since draft seven?
It's still called draft seven, and yes, it's changed.
I'll take a copy.
May I have one?
I'll take one.
October 27th.
Get three.
Oh, that's a town meeting.
I thought the same thing. It's late.
She gets one.
Did you get, so what do we need to do, read this last?
So just as a technicality, we had a conversation with a constable who raised a question about the... Can we just do the procedural thing?
Yeah, this is an administrative...
And my idea is that we will run through this very quickly because I know the hour is late and everybody wants to get numbered.
Right.
But we have important work to do, and so... The first thing is the constable started talking about the postings of the warrant. And a question was raised as to whether we've gone through the entire process of adopting the posting locations. And so Jessica asked that the board re-vote the postings. And the technical language is, and you are hereby directed to serve this warrant by posting attested copies in the usual places, one at Town Hall, one at the Hadley Post Office, one at the Goodwin Memorial Library, and in said town 14 days at least, not including the day of posting before the time of holding said meeting. So the locations are what we're voting
right
on.
So moved.
Can we add a location to that, amend it?
You're not required to.
But can we?
You may.
For the benefit of the people in North Hadley, they have a bulletin board at the Sugar Shack where they could go in, and there's a lot of people that frequent that place, and I think it would be a good location.
Would we typically do a private commercial enterprise?
Right, so this is not recommended. Do it on public land.
We can put it there, but don't mandate it.
Yeah, don't make it as part of your legal requirement.
Right. Okay, we have a
second
motion made.
Motion.
Second motion, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, thank you.
Given under your hands this day.
Okay, thank you for that technical thing. Okay. So there's just to provide a little bit of context, whatever we do tonight, I'm going to be sending this draft warrant and the motions to council and to bond council for final review. Next week, on the 12th, you're having a tri-board at 6 o'clock. And at the end of the evening, whatever you have in your hands, you have to sign, and I have to post it the next day on the 13th. If we don't post on the 13th, we don't have a town meeting. So we're down to the wire. There's still a lot of work to be done, so the hour is late. Let's dig into it. The first thing I thought that we would accomplish tonight is the division of motions. And if you just want to take one and pass one down. The second thing that we would do is run through the articles one by one.
Oh my god.
Well, we're going to do this very quickly because I think that we can focus in with laser-like precision on where we need to be. Mm-hmm. Next week you'll be taking your votes to recommend or not to recommend the articles. So, and I intend to keep your agenda for next week as free as possible from other items of business.
Mm-hmm.
So Article 1, I have prepared for you a summary of where I think we are, where we want to go. Take one, pass it down.
Point of order. Your deletes here, are you taking those out?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so are we going to change these numbers in the near future?
Yes, sir. You're going to take these out and we're going to re-vote the sequence of the
articles. I can't stand all this at this hour.
So I'm giving you this information right now, and I'm asking you to take it under advisement because we've seen it for the first time. But it relates to Article 1 and how much free cash we have to expend in order to balance the FY17 budget. At the end of the annual town meeting, we passed a budget which we told everybody was $124,000 short, that we needed to raise an additional $124,000 at the special town meeting in order to complete the budget, so that we can set a tax rate and move on. Since town meeting, a number of things have happened, one of which is that we've gotten new growth that came in at a higher amount than we thought it would. And we also had the governor sign the cherry sheet, and so we got a different financial package from the state than we expected. The net result is that we were able to narrow that gap on the 124,000 to 89,000 and change, 85,818. I'm working with the accountant to come up with a free cash figure. Right now, we're still using a planning number of $500,000.
Is that conservative?
That's conservative.
Okay, thank you.
It's probably a little higher than that. Not 600,000, but not 500,000. I think it's going to be a little bit higher than 500,000. So, but based upon the 500,000, I thought, how can we maximize the benefit to the requested budget increases, give everybody a modest COLA in line with the union increases, and have enough left over for the capital article and article number 7. So I've put together a preliminary spending plan based upon the $500,000 of free cash that would narrow that gap of 85,000, would fully fund the OPEB at our target of 251,125, restore 75,000 to the schools, provide expanded programs and other adjustments as I recommend, which are less than what's been requested. And that would provide us with a balance of positive 23,688, which we then would start applying towards capital projects. That $23,000 can be augmented by the capital stabilization balance of 8,349, which is in there currently. And then if Article 4 is passed, then we have an additional $3,700 in change to add to that, bringing that estimated total available for capital expenses up to $35,803, not counting the borrowing, not counting the water reserves, not counting the sewer impact fees, not counting the water stabilization account, not counting the other reserves that we have.
How about meals tax?
Meals tax was $315.
Would that be added?
No, would not be added.
You're not funding capital stabilization.
That we would be funding capital stabilization at an amount far less than that what we had hoped.
But that's so Article 6 is the 315 that Jerry's referring to, which we historically for a few years have done.
Right.
So
right.
We would not be doing that.
We would not be able to fund it at that level.
Okay.
Again, we still are working with a planning number for the free cash, so as that number gets more refined, we can do more with that article to fund the capital stabilization account. There's also another article out there that we're trying to track down that might add a little bit more money to this, and we'll have that answer for you tomorrow. So that's where we are with Article 1 of the omnibus budget, is that trimming our sales, we can make do. We may not be able to do everything that everybody's asked for us for. It will not give us the $315 for right. the meals tax transfer.
But we're also fully, let me rephrase that, but we're also funding the planned OPEB payment in full.
That's right, the target would be met.
Target, thank you, that's the word I was looking for.
Can you explain a little more about the expanded programs? Is that town hall, IT, and things of that nature?
No, that would be in the capital article.
Okay, but what would this be for?
And if you look at Article 1, you see the expanded programs. So, for example, the assessor's expenses of $6,066 mm-hmm. right here. So I have recommended that we reduce that to $1,250. Because that would cover the GIS layering module, but not the other things that they've asked for.
Okay.
So you can, if you look on page in this document here, and again, I don't want to spend a lot of time tonight, ask you to take it under advisement. Over here on this expenses, you see what the COLA looks like, what the requested program expansion is, and what I'm recommending. And in these, in most cases, I've recommended what is either obvious or I've been in consultation with the department and said, we can't do everything, what do you really need? And they've come back with an answer.
Mm-hmm. The COLA expansion is in line with the unions,
right?
Pretty much.
That's right.
Good, thank you.
All right, Article 2.
John?
Not the year 919.
Sorry, what document are you on?
Not 919, your OPA.
Yep.
Yep.
I've asked you quite a few times for the balance of that.
That on balance?
Why doesn't it show up there?
Well,
fluctuates.
I understand that, but that's a number that I would like to look at.
The balance in the fund or the balance of the unfunded liability?
Unfunded liability.
In the budget that I presented to you back in January on page 20, on the bottom of the page is the balance that you're seeking. And I'll read that out for you. That unfunded liability is $6,990,969.
And that was before the contributions were made in the last two fiscal years.
Right, yes.
Right, so that's going to get updated every single year.
And it's going to get updated again.
Well, I just think it's important to bring to the taxpayer and let them know what's still unfunded.
So this,
you know, we're putting $250,000 into it towards our debt.
Yeah.
But, you know, that has to be brought in.
And we're probably one of the only towns and around us that are doing it, because there are many throughout the state that haven't even put a cent in it.
Okay.
So we're at least trying to meet some type of obligation with that.
Right.
I understand
well,
that.
I think
but
we'll
we're looking
that.
At buildings, well, we're looking at $1 million worth of buildings to invest in.
Yeah. So
I want everything out in front of the taxpayer before we vote
it.
On.
So for
six
the forum,
million ain't gonna change their mind.
Should I stop? The forum is a great place to address that. That's the whole point of the forum, is to bring all of that information together in one place.
If
so
he would show up for him, it would be great.
To John's point, so we'll make sure that information is there.
I'll show up, now that you got numbers on it. I'm not going to waste time talking about nothing all day.
David,
all
you want to keep going?
Yes, so Article 2, speaking of not having information, they've gotten no information on this, so I think given this late hour that we need to defer this one to the annual town meeting, so I'm recommending that we delete Article 2.
Okay, do you need a motion from us to do so, or?
No.
Or you can?
All those in favor, yay.
Do you need a motion?
A motion would be helpful.
Okay, did you just make one?
I did make one.
A second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Article 3 is a transfer from HPAT. This is something that we had planned, and that would transfer the remaining balance that's in the gift account over to the enterprise fund, and that way that we will complete that. I think I've put that on the consent agenda because it really is a housekeeping issue.
This is like a slam dunk article. Can we take a vote on that now tonight? Or we don't want to do any voting.
Let's just go
through them all together.
Yeah.
Let's because it's very simple.
Okay, so the next one is the fund balances, which are taking old articles where we have money sitting unproductively. Some of these are small balances, less than $20. Some of them are fairly substantial at almost $25,000, but they're unproductive. Let's transfer those back to the original appropriation. In most cases, that's capital stabilization, but it also is sewer reserves, sewer impact fee fund, and sewer water reserves, as well as cleaning up a bunch of old borrowing where we have surplus money lying around. Let's clean that up. So that has no impact upon the tax rate. It returns money back into the appropriate accounts, and it frees up debt capacity. So,
David, has the sewer impact fees reflected the final plans that we had talked about.
For the clarifier?
No, for Lorena Lane and for the pump station.
Yes, so we received...
They got the figures for it?
We pulled back the $3,000 for the return.
Lorena Lane.
Okay. Lorena Lane and the $5,000 for the pump station.
Yeah, five or six, so I thought you said, yeah.
Those are the numbers in front of you. Article 5 is the bond premiums to be applied. This is a simple majority. It's not on the consent agenda because it probably will generate some discussion. Article 6, we're not going to make $315,000, but we can transfer what we have. Article 7, here's an article that's still in motion. The Capital Planning Committee is meeting on October 17th to finalize this. But if you see that the number of capital, I wanted to bring to your attention the number of capital items that are being asked for. Rather than go through 20 different motions, I've tried to combine this into 6 motions. So if you take a look at the motions, I've tried to take things that are like and bundle them together so that we have the cash appropriation into one motion. We have a borrowing on IT in another motion. Borrowing into for an HVAC in another motion, so that we're not here all night. So if that's agreeable to you.
Sorry.
Okay. The one thing that has been requested is on motion 5, on page 9. The Municipal Building Committee does not want their HVAC system to be bundled in with the school department's HVAC system. So they've asked this to be handled in 2 motions. Can take that under advisement.
So what's the split?
So motion number 5 separate?
Yeah, so 45 would be for the public safety complex and 400,000 would be for the school department.
And who wanted to separate these?
The Municipal Building Committee wants to separate them.
Okay.
So you're going to make 2 different motions?
Yeah.
If that's agreeable
under
to you.
Under the same... Okay.
I'd do this in 7 motions, in
all
other
right.
words.
That makes sense, because one could pass without the other, or both could right. fail together, so live on its own merit.
Okay.
Well, that's fine with me. Does all anybody right. have a strong opinion to the contrary?
Really, all of them should be separate, but I know you're not going to go along with that anyway.
Article 8 is the fire substation. Right now the amount is $3,600,000. There is a alternative amount of $2,800,000, which was suggested by a member of your subcommittee, but I understand that you haven't entirely embraced that number yet.
Right, we didn't vote for that.
Yeah, so.
Okay, so that's still in motion.
That's
okay.
Still in motion. Article 9 is a senior, and I guess the placement of articles is a question here, because we have 3 articles on North Hadley and 1 in the senior center, and we've sort of got senior centers sandwiched in between. So I'd like to reposition these articles so that this is a clearer progression.
Okay.
Okay.
Reposition in what order?
I think the seniors have asked to go first. I think the municipal, the ad hoc committee has asked to go first. So I would defer, I would say the seniors go first.
That's my only reason with that would be by the Buildings and Needs Committee, their priority is public safety. And they said that is their number one priority. So I think public safety should go before senior citizen building, because that's the request of the Building and Needs Committee.
One thing that we could do that might mitigate the concern about the ordering is that before we actually move into the, you know, just focus on one article,
mm-hmm.
in advance of the building articles, have a general overview again. I mean, this will be fine for the people that come to the public forum a week in advance, but for mm-hmm. the people who are just showing up at town meeting, which will be the lion's share that night,
mm-hmm.
If we could have talking points to make it clear to people what they're about to be asked to vote on, so that they understand we're We're going to be talking about the substation. We're also going to be talking about a senior center, and there are also non-monetary library articles that are all related to building.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of, I mean, I think we need to frame that for people so that whichever building we take first, from a vote standpoint, everybody understands that there's another one coming right behind it.
Okay.
That's just a suggestion. I think that would be helpful under any set of circumstances.
You all want to think about it, or do you want to take an action?
I don't see any difference. Like Joyce said, everybody's got their mind made up how they're going to vote anyway, so.
Well, I think there are a lot of people that will listen to
that. Ain't what she said.
I did not.
No. Come on. It's too late to be bickering. Let's do that at the beginning of the meetings from now on.
I don't think I said
So do we want to think about it? Do people have a strong feeling tonight?
Now, apparently they would like to go first because of the lateness of the meeting and the elderly population. Is that the reasoning behind this?
Suzanne, Jane, would you like to speak to that?
Suzanne. They have requested that they be placed as close to the beginning of the meeting because many of them are going to be carpooling. I understand. I totally understand.
She's just
position.
Speaking.
I'm just
articulating.
You know, articulating what they had asked me for. I understand this is something that you all have to decide.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever you think is best, I know.
What we would like, Susan, or what I would like, Suzanne, is for everybody to understand that each one of these articles is just as important as the other. And if you're not in agreement with the substation and it's the senior center that they want, then people need to stay and be at town meeting for all of these important articles that are going to be voted on that night. Every single one of them is important. And I think, you know, I think that that's where they need to go.
Yeah, I totally understand that. I think some of this came from how late the other meeting actually went because of the tiny house.
We don't want to pit them right now against one another by positioning of the articles. Each one is very important to certain people in this town.
Understood.
To try to make it somewhat dispassionate, David, do you have any idea which article was placed first, initially, before we had any of this?
Senior center was placed first.
Before the North Hadley substation?
Right.
The initial warrant?
Yes.
This fire station was number 4 initially.
No,
and it was moved to number 8.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of a request for an article, did we...
I'm sorry, I don't understand the question.
Yeah, was there... Do you recall who requested which article first? Or was this just reacting to the select board, you put them on at the same time anyway? They were all part of the very first draft warrant?
Yes, so there was... I would have to go back over my notes. I can't recall whether the fire substation was even on the preliminary warrant. I think it wasn't. But I know the senior center was.
And I feel because it's by petition, it shouldn't change also.
I don't understand, Donald. What do you mean?
Because it's a petition article that was submitted, and you can't change that article. You can't add to it or delete from it. It has to remain exactly like it is.
Yeah, no, we're talking about the ordering. We're not
and I think it should stay exactly where it is. Why should we be changing things, jumping ship in the middle of the ocean?
I think David just said because... All right, so you want to leave the articles as is?
Yes.
No, I think you should put all of the fire station together, whether they're ahead of the senior center or behind the senior center.
That I agree,
those
but that's logical.
Those three should be together.
Yeah, that's the only
it's
thing
going to generate a progressive conversation and to stop and start with a whole different topic will maybe make it more difficult for people to decide what they want.
I agree.
The petition on the fire, if the first passes, they're just going to be passed over. What are they talking about?
All right, so let's move on because it sounds like we understand the problem and it's a matter of us to think about it and we have other fish to try.
I'm kind of hungry too. I think some fried fish.
All right.
Go ahead.
All right, Article 10 is North Hadley Fire Station submitted by petition. Article 11 is the instruction to demolish North Hadley Village Hall. Article 12 has been withdrawn by the Municipal Building Committee. Articles 13 and 14 are the library articles. Article 15 is permission to adjust fees by the departments. And Article 16 is if we don't get 15, we pass, we adopt 16. If we get 15, we pass over 16. 17 is a bylaw amendment to require good standing if somebody wants a permit from the town. 18 is a land transfer on Chimura Road. 19, this is a question for the select board. The developer of Gooseberry Lane wants the town to take it over as a public way. It meets the criteria for the planning board. It does not meet the criteria for the DPW. There are two deficiencies in the road. There's some crack sealing that needs to happen. The other is there's a broken water valve and the service line to lot number 3. The developer has said he's not going to make those corrections. So I look to the select board as to what you want to do about Gooseberry Lane.
If they have not met the planning boards.
They have met the planning board.
But they haven't met the DPW.
But not the DPW.
Don't accept them.
I don't accept it. I'll make a motion not to accept it until he fixes it.
Right.
Is there a second?
Anyone want to second that?
I'll second it for discussion. Do we have any idea what the cost would be to rectify it?
You know, we just accepted two roads, one on the south side of town and Holly Road.
Yeah, but we didn't.
I know.
No, I'm just saying, that's, again, you know, I always worry about setting a precedent. I mean.
Yeah.
Why should the town pick up the expense?
Yeah, I.
Well, let's find out what the expense is, if we could get a.
That's not your problem.
If it's $300, it's one thing. If it's $40,000, it's different.
All right. So CPA number one, Article 20, is for Lake Warner Dam, and all we're doing is for extending the deadline for use of town funds there.
How are they coming on the planning on that?
Very good. There's going to be an announcement coming out by the state in the next day or so.
Oh, good.
Article 21 is $15,000 for design for the playing fields. And then there are four zoning articles. And that is it for that. Do you want to take the this and think about the provision of motions?
Yes.
Yes.
We never make recommendations on zoning articles, correct?
Correct. You can speak to it if you want as a citizen, but.
That's the planning board will deal with that.
So I have only one other item in business for the board, which is not related to the special town meeting.
Is this the Art of Callum?
This is the grant.
Okay.
Last year, we applied for a federal grant, transportation grant, called the FLAP grant, for access improvements to the Silvio County Wildlife Refuge and off Moody Bridge Road. We didn't get that grant. We have an opportunity to apply for it again. The last time, the select board said that they were generally in favor of it, and I would like to see if the select board are still generally in favor of it. Requires a in-kind match of about $4,000, which is easily made by the town.
Do you understand what we're going to do with this grant? I wasn't on the board when this grant was first initiated.
Sure. This grant is to improve the handicap accessibility to the viewing platforms of the Silvio County Wildlife Refuge, which is a federal wildlife refuge off of Moody Bridge Road. They'll provide some road improvements in order to address some of the rutting and gravel.
They want a stone and wheel 3,200 feet of it.
Yeah.
That's what we had voted on last time.
Yeah.
And how much was, it was grant, their grant money, and we had to put in, how much was it?
It's the infrastructure of the road we're doing. You're doing the rest of it, so the...
Yeah, it was an in-kind match, which I can't remember the amount, but it was minimal. I want to say it was fewer than $5,000.
Yeah.
You know, all the labor that we would provide.
And I think Michael Oskey was very much in favor of it.
No, this is federal grant money, Donald.
Yeah, but I mean, the matching part, he's talking about building a road or something.
No, it's in-kind, so our highway department can actually assist, right? Wasn't that the...
Yeah, so we review plans, so I review a plan, so that's my time, Marla's time.
Doesn't have to be monetary, Donald.
Yeah, it's not a cash match.
But the highway department isn't involved for rebuilding this road at all?
No.
No, okay, fine.
Donald, what happened was we weighed the maintenance that we're putting into that road right now for grading and gravel and drainage and drain pipes and stuff like that. So the Silvio County people had approached us to finish that road with stone and oil or pavement, depending on what we wanted, and we had agreed with stone and oil and to finish that road, so we don't have to maintain it anymore.
So that would just be from...
From like the corner where it caved in at one time to...
But it's not all the way to South Maple?
No.
It's only a short distance?
Just the dirt part is all they were...
3,200 feet, isn't it?
3,200 feet, it says in the...
So does somebody want to make a motion one way or the other?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, to reapply?
To reapply.
Reapply.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Upstate.
All right, and then the last thing is, oh yes, the Bay Road Bridge project, we're actually moving on that. The Army Corps of Engineers is crawling all over the bridge just yesterday.
I haven't seen anybody.
They've been down there for about a week now, actually.
I was there, there was five different agencies, 12 engineers there, and they said to me that they're placing this on fast track to get it done.
Excellent.
So, which was good news.
So they...
What does that mean?
I don't know. That's why they were all there, federal, state...
When snows fly.
Hey, faster than they were this summer on it.
Let David complete his sentence for the viewing audience, and...
So the town layout is about 66 feet, which constricts their ability to get to the underside of the bridge. So they're looking for rights of way on either private property on the upstream side or town property on the downstream side. And they're asking if the town would be interested in providing those rights of way on the downstream side so that we wouldn't be impacting private property.
Whatever it takes to get it done.
What can I...
So moved.
So moved.
Second?
I'll second the motion.
Okay, all in favor?
Oh, you did?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you, that's all I have for the board tonight.
All right, any announcements this evening before we...
Yes, will you please fix your sign that says the meeting is going to be at 6:30 and at 8:30, and put 6:30 to 8:30, because I assume you're not doing it twice.
Oh, for the forum? Oh, okay, all right.
Because it's very misleading.
Yeah, okay, sounds like it's different.
Several people say, which one are you going to, 6:30 or 8:30?
It's the 19th.
I don't think that's what they mean.
Right, so...
October 19th.
Just remind everybody, from 6:30 to 8:30...
Yeah, somebody needs to just...
We have a public forum scheduled, the purpose of which is to review all of the warrant articles that will be presented the following week at our regular special town meeting scheduled for October 27th. So again, it's Wednesday, October 19th, 6:30 to 8:30 at Hopkins...
Academy.
Academy, yes, it's at Hopkins Academy. The more the merrier, it'll be an opportunity to ask questions and get clarification in advance of the meeting.
Are you going to have a reflection of what all these articles will cost the taxpayers?
Yes.
Every one of them?
Yes, well, yes, the ones that we have information for.
The ones that require money.
That's a loaded answer.
No, well, meaning, I mean, right now, we still have like a moving target on the substation, so... Any announcements, additional announcements, or are we ready to...
I'd like to make an announcement, please.
Okay.
On October 15th, from the North Hadley Sugar Shack, the
tractor parade's going to be, and the fall festival. It's going to start at 11 o'clock and run through 4 o'clock, with the traditional parade starting at 2 o'clock. Again, that's October 15th, Saturday, starting at 11, tractor parade at 2. The fall festival, that's Sugar Shack.
Excellent.
And I have condolences to the Sabasco family on the passing of Robert this past week, so we send our condolences to them.
And also the Kessel Trust is putting on a 5K race.
October 16th. Yep, and the sign for that is on the Saturday.
And remind the select board that we have a walkthrough of buildings on October 15th.
Yep, right, everybody at 10:30 that morning. And then, John, you're not going to be able to make it.
Okay. That's going to be starting from where? The walkthrough will start where?
We haven't determined that yet.
Municipal Building Committee is going to, I think we're convening here at Town Hall, but I'm not positive. So.
Would you like to be informed of that when we find
out? Then the other thing is just to remind select board members, I have one evaluation form for our town administrator turned in to me.
I got it. I'll get it to you tomorrow. How's that?
Okay. And so I need two more.
Well, I was on vacation. Oh, I did turn them in.
You didn't turn them in yet. I thought we were going to have a meeting or something. That's why I didn't work on them.
No, they all get turned in to me, but they're all published individually.
I don't have it.
Yeah, I didn't realize we were doing them. Now I thought we were going to discuss it or something. I'll work on it.
Yeah, yeah.
Sorry.
So you,